Call Art Bell toll-free west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies at 1-800-825-5033. 1-800-825-5033. This is the CBC Radio Network.
Welcome to Ghost AM. Thought I'd add a little spirit to the night. Good to be with you, everybody. I'm Art Bell, and we'll be here all night long. Nothing but ghost stories. The ground rules are simple. You tell the story, we'll listen. But it's got to be a real one. Heaven knows, is it heaven? There are plenty of them out there. And going back now to a caller, my first caller, I might add, on WJR in Detroit. And you said your radio station, sir, covers 38 states. I just got a fax from somebody. Said WJR 760 from Detroit is coming in here gangbusters, and he sends the fax from Birmingham, Alabama. His name is Ron. So there you are, all the way down in Alabama.
You can get it in Detroit, Alabama.
Listen, Detroit, as we all know, is the center of some pretty strange activity upon Halloween.
Yeah.
And I know there's a lot of volunteers out in your streets tonight trying to keep things quiet. I assume so far they are quiet.
Well, they haven't been too bad. I just had to go outside. My wife said she heard somebody parking out front.
Great.
And it's like we had a car stolen out front 2 days ago, so... it's not the best neighborhood, but then again, it's not the worst.
Mm. Well, I've got a way to keep people inside. Did you hear last hour the Bigfoot sound I played?
Oh, yeah.
You did, huh?
All right. I heard my dog.
Uh-huh. Well, I've got something else I want. If there's anything that'll keep the people in Detroit inside, try and imagine this outside. Listen carefully now. How'd you like to meet something like that out in the middle of the street in the middle of the night?
Well, you know, I think I just heard that a few minutes ago. My wife's 8 3/4 months pregnant.
Oh, geez. Well, I hope she stays that way.
Yeah. Well, as a matter of fact, we were almost going to have the baby today, being Halloween, but we're going to have it tomorrow.
Well, I hope I didn't bring anything premature, so...
Oh, no.
Anyway, have you ever seen anything you could not explain?
I had when I was about 20 years ago, me and my brother and sister got together, and we decided we were going to get out the old Ouija board and have a seance.
Yes.
And, of course, the first person you call up from the dead is George Washington, and nothing seemed to happen, and all the lights were out in the house, and then my brother decided that he was going to call Satan, and...
Oh, really? Poor idea.
Yeah, and next thing you know, we heard a gust of wind, and the front door, we had a vestibule at the front of the house, mm-hmm. and just a flimsy door, and that swung shut. So it would have taken an action of somebody pulling it or suction, you know, a really strong breeze or something to shut the door.
Sure.
And we got startled, and we ran over there and didn't see anything. And we flicked on the light, and the light didn't work.
Mm-hmm.
So we went to get a light bulb. We put it in, and we had like a 2x4 carpet in the vestibule, and the impression left on the carpet was the trident, the devil's spear, the pitchfork.
Yes, oh yes, I know.
And nobody would have had the opportunity to do it, and they would have had to do it in the dark.
I'll tell you something, and I'll tell everybody else a brief story, which I sort of said I was never going to tell again. But that's a good one, sir. Thank you. And thank you, and we shall always remember you, by the way, as caller number one from Detroit. What is your first name again?
My name is KC.
KC. KC from Detroit. Brother, thank you.
Well, it's good listening to you, Art, and I'm sure you're going to get a lot more listeners from Detroit.
All right. Thank you. Yeah, good to be on the air there. Well, when I worked in Las Vegas, and for a number of years I did the program in Las Vegas, from the Union Plaza Hotel, it was called at that time. And one night when I was doing a show, this very night, as a matter of fact, a lady called up and claimed to be a witch. She gave me some very, very disconcerting information, personal knowledge, which I actually bleeped off the air. It was so personal, I couldn't believe that she could possibly know these things about me. And toward the end of the call, she said she was going to come and leave something for me. Well, she left me a Ouija board, an ancient Ouija board. I have never, nor will I to this day, tell you what has happened to that Ouija board. But when you call upon spirits, when you call upon the dark side, and you do it with something, an instrument, it does not matter, you'd better be damn careful what you're doing. Ouija boards are an opening. They're an opening into a world where there are things that you may not really wish to meet. So my advice to you, without telling you the detailed story of this board, which is frightening, my advice to you is do not play with Ouija boards. It's like opening a door, and you just don't know what's going to walk through. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hi.
Art.
Yes.
Hello, how you doing?
Okay, you're going to have to get into that phone and yell at us.
All right, how's this?
I'm much better.
All right, thanks.
Where are you?
I'm in Spokane.
Spokane, Washington, KPA.
Mighty KPA.
You bet.
I have a story for you.
All right, go ahead.
It's a doozy. About a year ago, I was staying at a friend's house up in Newport.
Mm-hmm.
And we were sitting down in the basement, right?
Yes.
And we were sitting there smoking cigarettes and talking back and forth.
Doing guy stuff.
Yeah. And I was sitting there, and I was watching my smoke from my cigarette go up, and all of a sudden, I seen a face kind of appear into it, you know, the smoke going up into the air.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked my friend, you know, do you see it? And he's like, yeah. And it smiled kind of, and then...
It smiled?
Yeah, it just smiled. And
now, I could understand people blow smoke rings.
Yeah.
I could even understand blowing a face, but I can't understand it smiling.
Yeah, it just kind of formed into a face. It
was
the strangest thing I've ever... I still get shivers now.
And it smiled at you.
Yes.
Well, it's better to frown.
Yeah.
And what happened to it then? Did it...
It just kind of dissipated really slowly.
God, that's weird.
He's told me about stories about seeing things in his house before, too, so.
Well, I'll tell you then a little story. I have a photograph. Thank you very much for the call. I have a photograph of a ghost, a real ghost. It might be a wonderful night for some of you to get this photograph. If you have a computer and a modem, we've got a bulletin board service, and you can go in and get a photograph of this ghost. Actually, there are several ghost photographs. Oh, by the way, my guest this last Sunday on Dreamland, sent me a photograph of a tornadic ghost. I don't know if that's a word. But it is obviously some sort of plasma material at the top of a staircase in the shape of a tornado. Now, down toward the bottom of the tornado, it's translucent. In other words, you can begin to look through it and see the stairs. It's the damnedest thing you've ever seen. I'm going to get that one up on the bulletin board for you as soon as they send it to me to scan. I've got a scan of it right now, but I want to be able to scan it myself at a higher resolution rate. If you want to see a ghost, there is a man in Arizona who was a stone mason. He built stone, you know, he did basements. And he did a wine cellar for a fellow in about a 100-year-old house. He was very proud of the work that he did. And when he was done, he took a photograph of his stone masonry work. It was beautiful. Only thing is, when the picture came out, quite clearly a translucent being appeared in the photograph, and it was captured very, very well on film. And we have published this photograph in our newsletter. And I might add, I've got it on our bulletin board, so if you want to download the picture of the ghost, you can call area code 702-727-1709, 24 hours a day. Let me give that number to you again, 702-727-1709. And if you're able to download with Z-modem protocol, you can download a photograph of this ghost. You take a look. There's a face, there's a body, there's arms, there's legs. It's a ghost. It's clear. It's in color. There's no mistake about it. There's some sort of spirit, some sort of entity in that photograph, and you're welcome to download it and take a look for yourself. We do a lot of that. We try to make some of this material available to you, so it does not all have to be the theater of the mind. That's what radio is. I want you to be able to see what I see so that you can see that I'm not totally crazy. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Hi, Art. This is Aaron calling from Los Banos, California.
Hi.
Hi. I have a really good ghost story I wanted to tell you.
Let her go.
Okay. This story happened in 1951. It was given to me by my father, and it happened to his cousin named Norbert. And he was at a movie theater and in Morgan Hill, California, and he was leaving, going towards San Jose, and there's a stretch of road they call Monterey Highway that they called the Blood Alley. And one night after the movie was done, he was heading home to San Jose, heading north.
Sure.
And he was going about 45 miles an hour in his old car.
I know the road, by the way.
Yeah. And there's a little highway, and while he was going up there, he saw this, you know, beautiful young-looking lady on the side of the road and walking really slowly. And he kind of slowed down, and he was looking over at her, and she had a beautiful white dress on, and she was looking down, and he slowly passed her. And he looked in his rearview mirror, and he saw her, and he slowed down a little bit more and was going, you know, 15, 10 miles an hour. And for some reason, he got a really nervous feeling inside, and he slowly sped up because he was scared. He didn't know, you know, exactly what it was, and you know what the if it was something different. He got a different feeling inside,
mm-hmm.
And well, he said it. He sped up a little bit. And he was going about 35, 40 miles an hour, and he happened to look back again, and it didn't go any further away. It wasn't leaving. And that really started.
You mean the lady in the white dress was as close to him?
Yes, as it was the first time he saw her.
Uh-huh.
And he really started getting nervous. And, well, he put his foot on the pedal and got up to about 50, 55 miles an hour.
Sure.
And he looked in the mirror, and it wasn't any. As a matter of fact, it was getting closer to him. It was getting closer to his car.
Really?
On the passenger side.
There are many, sir, that have died on that road.
Yes, very. There was a lot of fatal accidents back in the 50s and earlier on and later on also. And as he got up to speed, he started really stepping on. He was frightened now. By this time, he was really frightened. He was going, you know, tipping the car out to, I guess, 70, 75 miles an hour is what he said.
That'd be my reaction.
Yeah, he was really moving now.
I'm the let's get out of here kind of person.
Yes, yes. And he looked in the mirror this time, and he looked in the, as a matter of fact, he didn't look in the mirror. He looked over to his right side where his little side mirror was, you know, mm-hmm. to get a better picture. And, you know, the worst thing possibly happened that he thought would happen. And there was a white dress floating next to the car. And when he looked at the window, he said he saw a face of a skeleton with white straw hair looking at him with its mouth opened. And he was so frightened that he could not believe it. He slammed his brakes on in the middle of the road. It was late at night. In the middle of the road, slammed his brakes on, you know, closed his eyes as tight as he could, said a prayer. And when he looked back, it was gone. He turned around and went back to his mother's house, which was about 20 miles the other way, and didn't go look back at all. And he went home and he told the story and told it to the whole family. And as far as I know, he never went down that road again. If he could.
These things change your life forever.
Yes.
You know, it's thank you very much for the call. It's one thing to tell them. It's another to really experience them. When you do, it changes your life forever and ever. Because it does not matter what anybody else believes or chuckles about or laughs about. If you experience something like that, you're never, ever going to be the same. Although we eat food every day, we take for granted the process it goes through. Well, you should not. This is Digestive Tract Commercial 101. Digestive Tract 101. You see, in your digestive tract, there are bacteria, or there should be. Now, they're not bad, they're good. What they do is convert the energy, the nutrition from the food, and send it into your body so you feel well. They eliminate the poison. Now, if this bacteria should die, that's bad. Then the opposite occurs, and your body gets poisons, and you get rashes, and you get sick, and it's not good. Now, there is a way to correct it, and, you know, let me tell you something. It's called Natron's Healthy Trinity. Now, what kills that bacteria? Antibiotics, bad diets, alcohol, drugs, stress, even basic aging. You know who takes it? Dan Marino. And a lot of other players on the Miami Dolphins take it. You know why? Because they take antibiotics, and that kills the bacteria, and then they just, you know, they're not ready for a good game. So they take Natron's Healthy Trinity. And you can, too. You can order it by calling 1-800-992-3323. It restores, you see, your body's natural balance. Whatever has killed it, Natron's replaces it. 1-800-992-3323. In a world gone crazy, it's kind of nice to be able to relax, put on some music, and just let it all go. That's what Higher Octave Music does for me with artists like Cusco, Neil Sean, Shaheen and Zapair, Craig Shakizo. It's music that takes you to a very nice place and then lets you down easy. Their current offer is absolutely terrific. Neil Sean, Craig Shakizo, and of course, Shaheen and Zapair. Their albums, Beyond the Thunder, Acoustic Highway, and E as in Ecstasy. You've heard me play this cutting-edge music on the show. Now add it to your collection. You know the great prices they offered on Cusco? Well, they're back. Three terrific CDs, $39.95 or $27.95 if you prefer cassettes. Call the people at the Higher Octave Music label directly at 1-800-562-8283. 24 hours a day. Remember, mention my name, whether for relaxing or exercising or just getting together with good friends. This is the music, and you've got the number. 1-800-562-8283. That's 1-800-562-8283. Higher Octave, the name for 21st century music. All right, my recommendation is turn down the lights, if you have the guts to do it, and listen carefully. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Good morning.
Good morning. This is Dennis from Vancouver.
Washington?
Yes.
All right.
Let's see. I've got a ghost story. Sort of a ghost story.
Almost a ghost story. Look, that's like being almost pregnant. Either you're a spirit or you're a physical entity. It's one or the other.
Well... I'll explain it and
All right.
I'll go from there.
All right, then maybe I can tell you.
I was up in Yosemite, you know, National Park in California.
Yes.
And doing a Ouija board. There were, I guess, about 10 or 12 people in the room. There was only two of us on the board. The other people were, you know, standing around watching, contributing their energy. And we got something that came across as being, you know, negative. I don't necessarily want to say evil, but definitely negative-oriented.
Do you want to tell us what it was?
Well, it wouldn't give us a name, but the impression that I have was that it was something higher up than just an ordinary demon. It was very strong, very intelligent.
Now, was this manifesting itself simply through moving on the Ouija board and spelling things out, or was it...
That's the way it started.
Okay.
We were, you know, asking questions of it. You know, at first we didn't know that it was evil, but, you know, having done the Ouija board for several years prior to that, you know, we've learned to ask appropriate questions to determine whether it's a positive or a negative entity.
Mm.
And after having determined that it was a negative entity, we were going to stop, but the rest of the people in the room wanted to continue because they were fascinated. So we went ahead and continued with it, which, of course, was our mistake. But, after a while, it told us to turn the lights off.
Listened, right?
Yeah, we turned the lights off. We turned the candle on.
All right,
lit a candle.
I'll tell you what. I'm coming up on a break. I want you to hold this story for the break, all right?
Okay.
All right, stay right where you are. We will shortly be back. You're listening to an annual event called Ghost to Ghost AM. I'm Art Bell. Put your seatbelts on, everybody. It's going to be a rough ride.
Taking calls on the wildcard line at 702-727-1295. That's 702-727-1295. First-time callers can reach Art Bell at 702-727-1222. 702-727-1222. Now, here again, Art Bell.
Top of the morning, everybody. Good to be here. It's Ghost Stories and Ghost to Ghost. All night long. Tell you what, let me take care of business here at the beginning, then we'll jump back into it. How's that? Clear sailing, right on up, or would that be broom riding to the top of the hour? For the past several months, North American Trading, months, almost a year, they've been telling you about the new currency. Well, it's here. $100 are going to change, $100 bills first, then the other denominations will quickly follow. And currency is changing. That's all there is to it. Now, there are at least three or four ways this new currency will affect your savings, your investments, just about all the holdings that you've got. They've got a wonderful offer for you. All you need to do is call them. It is a free call, and they will send you free information. Now, I'm telling you this, they sell gold. It's really a very tricky ad, because when you read about what's going on in the economy, buying gold is going to seem au naturel to you, so you don't really, they don't have to sell gold. It sells itself after you read this information, but the info is free, so call them. 1-800-877-9799. Is the number. 1-800-877-9799. The name of the company, once again, is North American Trading, and they're more than happy to do business with you, but right now, all they want to do is send you free information. In a moment, there'll be more. Folks, I've got on the line with me Dr. Greg Cinnamone, who helped to originate the amazing 18-hour phonics game. I've been telling you about this. It helps children, it helps teenagers as well as adults learn to read, understand, and comprehend better. Greg, what got you started in this endeavor?
Well, I'll tell you, I'm like a lot of people, I think, Art, where I tried another phonics method with my own kids. I have two school-age kids. I'm also a school therapist and did a lot of testing on kids as they're preparing to enter education. And our kids read horribly in our society today. In fact, here in California alone, we placed dead last in the nation, tied with Louisiana, in reading and spelling and grammar. In fact, last year alone, 20% of all high school graduates could not even read their high school diplomas. And so what got me interested in the phonics game is that we're in a mess here. And if we don't turn this around and figure out how to get back to basics, which is teaching the 44 sounds of the English language to our children and our teenagers, then I don't know where it's going to stop or where our kids are going to have to end up before we get back to the basics in education.
Well, of course, whenever America is compared to any other industrialized country, we always score at the bottom of the heap. Why are kids and adults having problems reading and spelling?
Well, it goes back to what they call whole word reading, and we thought we knew what we were doing when we switched over about 40 years ago to the speller, see, Jane, run, see, spot, jump, and what we didn't realize at that time, and we're just now starting to get it, was that was the wrong way to teach kids and teenagers to read, and we're getting back to phonics now. Tests are proving this out. The phonics game is the answer.
Greg, I've seen it. I've seen the phonics game, and I've talked to people who absolutely are in love with it. Tell everybody how they can get it.
It's a fun solution to a tough problem, and the way to get it is 1-800-211-READ, 1-800-211-READ, and the first 25 callers are going to get a free comprehension game and a free syllable game with their order.
All right. Listen, everybody, I'd suggest that what Greg has laid out before you right now is an opportunity to teach young people and adults how to read, spell, and comprehend better. That number again, Greg?
1-800-211-READ.
You can't go wrong. Thanks, Greg.
You're welcome, Art.
Myself, I'm a man of wealth and taste. I've been around for long, long years, stolen many a man's soul and fame. I was around when Jesus Christ had his moment of doubt and fame.
From the moment that I heard this, I realized it had to go on tonight. Good morning. This is Ghost to Ghost AM. Back now to our story, and I'm sorry we interrupted you, sir. You're back on the air again.
Oh, no problem. Let's see, where was I? It asked us to turn the lights off, so we lit a candle and we did turn the lights off.
Bad move.
Yeah, well, we found that out the hard way. We continued, you know, speaking with it for about a minute or so. Unbeknownst to us, back behind the group, towards the corner of a room, a light started to form in the middle of the air. It started off real small, but it was real bright. It was actually lighting up the room.
Right.
The room got real cold real fast. There was no bad smell or anything, but it was quite cold all of a sudden.
That'd be enough for me. Now, what I want to know, first of all, before you continue, is I'd be out of there. I mean, in a flash, I'd be out of there. Light begins to form where there ought not be light. The room gets cold. That'd be all I'd need.
Since my friend and I had been doing it for, you know, on a semi-regular basis for a couple of years, you know, we were fairly fluent at least up to that point. We hadn't, you know, gotten anything that strong before, but, you know, we pretty much knew how to, you know, deal with it once it got to that point.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my friend started getting sick to his stomach. I started, you know, getting a little bit of a headache. So we stopped, you know, with the board itself and basically moved back away, relaxed ourselves, started saying some prayers, started, at least I started imagining a golden light around myself, you know, which is what I consider a protective light. And, you know, went from there, and we just left the board alone, and the light did fade. We turned on the room lights itself, and, you know, the light just, you know, faded out. And
well, that's good. There are a lot of people who would say to you, you should have been praying in the first time, place, not messing around with the Ouija board.
Well,
because you know what can happen, sir?
Oh, yeah. I
you
know
can, you
that...
can bring something like that into
yeah.
this world or across from wherever it comes from, and you can put your Ouija board away, and it won't matter because it's in.
Right. Right, yeah. Once it's done its full transformation, crossover, yeah. But we managed to stop it in time.
So how? What would you advise people out there about Ouija boards?
Well, first of all, there are several good books out there. If you're really determined to use one, read the books on it first. The best thing to do is to, you know, one of the most common questions, if you get a negative-oriented spirit, one of the most common questions that it will ask is, can I come in? And never think that it's referring to coming into the room or into your home or whatever. When it's asking that question, it's wanting to come into you.
Oh.
And you always say no. And if you get a question like that, I would suggest that you stop and don't mess with it anymore.
Okie dokie. Thank you very much for the call. There are many out there who probably ought not mess around with this kind of thing at all. It's very serious. It's not a joke. A Ouija board is simply an instrument, in my opinion. Now, it may be a particularly powerful instrument, but you can invite these sorts of forces in with or without a Ouija board. And my advice to you is, don't do it. Like an unwelcome in-law coming to visit, it might not leave. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Top of the morning to you.
Hello, Art. This is Jeff. I'm calling from Denver.
Denver, yes, sir. Cahow, I imagine.
Yes, and I have a true fact story that I can relate to you about spirits, ghosts, or whatever you want to call them.
Let her rip.
I was living in an apartment complex, and a guy came over to me. I met him just inadvertently, and I was working in the legal field, and he asked me to check out whether or not his wife had been married before, and I did that, and I gave him information, and he came over to my apartment.
Had she been? I just want to know.
Absolutely.
okay.
Yeah. It was big me.
Oh my.
He was married to her for 10 years, and she never got a divorce.
Mm-hmm.
So he came over to my house. He was crying.
Sure.
I took him over to his apartment, tried to calm him down, and he went into a rage. He started tearing telephones out of the wall, breaking lamps, tables, etc. And then he came at me like he was going to attack me. He got right up close to me, and he fell down, and he started to convulse. And I thought, well, this guy has epilepsy or something.
Sure.
And then he jumped up again and did the same thing again and went down like someone hit him in the head with a ball bat. And it was frightening. The hair on my head went up. His eyes were rolling back. He was foaming at the mouth.
You're saying it was like he was in combat with some force.
I don't know what was going on, but what I can say that really frightened me was he was speaking out of his own mouth and cursing me and doing all this, but there were multiple voices coming out. Sometimes there were one, sometimes it sounded like two or three or five or six. Mm. And then he stopped breathing, and the guy was foaming at the mouth and that.
Oh my God.
I went down, I checked his pulse and all that. I had to give him CPR, get him breathing again, and I had to run over. He pulled the phone out of the wall. I had to run over to the neighbors and ask them to call the cops, and then the cops, the fire department, the EMTs, all of them came over. They took him off to ER, and I thought, well, you know, when he was talking to me, it was horrible. It was something I can't even explain.
What would you say? Would you think he was possessed, or was he being beaten by some outside force?
Well, all I can say is there were voices coming out of his body when his eyes were rolled back, and he was foaming at the mouth. He was writhing on the floor, and sometimes it sounded like one person talking. Sometimes it sounded like five, four, whatever, talking. And so I gave him the CPR. They took him off, and then that was about 11 o'clock at night. And then about 4 in the morning, they let him out of ER, and he came back to my apartment. And I said, get out of here. I don't want to talk to you.
I'm sure.
Leave. Go. Now. And then about 5 months after that, I met him in a parking lot of a shopping center. And I said, you know, do you realize what's going on? Do you understand? And he said, yeah, can you imagine what those cops did to my apartment? I said, the cops didn't do anything. You did that. And I talked with him for a while, and then he told me that he was an immigrant from France. He was in an orphanage in France, and as far as these convulsions and stuff, I asked him if he was epileptic or all that, and he said no. And I was talking with him, and then he said, you know, I was in an orphanage in France, and two priests told me I was possessed. And I said, oh, gee whiz, and that was the end of it. I didn't talk to him after that.
That's enough. All right, my friend, thank you. That's quite enough. Well, what to say about that? We were talking about inviting entities in a few moments ago. Maybe on occasion they invite themselves in. Maybe on occasion they take the minds of those who can be taken. Had you thought of that? Wildcard Line, you're on the air. Good morning.
Good morning, RWBC, Duluth Superior.
In Wisconsin.
Actually, I'm in Duluth. But
Duluth, Minnesota. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, your Detroit station is coming through pretty good, too.
All right.
Say, are you going to tell us what happened to your Ouija board?
Absolutely not.
Can't talk you into it, huh?
No, that's one story I really won't tell. It scares me, and I don't like telling it. Not even on this day. It scares the hell out of me. That's one thing that really did scare me. And I warn people about Ouija boards. How about you? Do you have a story?
Yeah, I got a quick one for you.
All right.
Back in the 50s, my mom was seeing a gentleman in her school. She was a junior in high school. They were really in love with each other, this, that, and the other thing. And one night, she was sleeping, and she just kind of stirred in bed, and she woke up and saw him standing in the room, her bedroom. She, what are you doing here? And he just kind of faded away.
No.
And the next day, she found out he was killed in a car accident, so.
Oh, there's a lot of stories like that. There's a lot of stories. Thank you very much. Now, you see, I believe we had Brad Steiger on a couple of weeks ago, and actually we've been kind of doing the warm-up to Halloween for some time now. But there are many, many stories like that. It seems when many die, the energy that is us, the energy that may be our soul, our essence, whatever it is you want to call it, you give your own name to it, has something that it must say to somebody that it has left behind. It must say it. And somehow, that energy, either still here on Earth or from elsewhere, finds its way back long enough to assure the person that it loves, or to pass a message that must be passed, information that a loved one must have, and somehow the energy makes it back. Don't ask me. I just do talk shows. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Thank you.
Where are you?
Pardon?
Where are you?
Corpus Christi, Texas.
All right. Welcome.
Welcome. Yes, I have several ghost stories, but I know I don't have that much time.
Now, give us your best.
Oh, the best. Okay. One time, my husband and I had a disagreement, and he had been, you know, just frolicking and carrying on, and I'd about had it. And I was very upset, and my mom told me, well, you need to cool down. And so she said, let's go to this thrift store that happened to be in a hospital. And we were walking down the corridor.
Why is it that when women get upset, they go shopping? It's true, isn't it?
Yeah, well, yeah, it is. But anyway, my mom and I were walking down the corridor, and in the hospital you hear there's like speakers, and there's like, you know, Dr. Jones. Dr. Jones wanted an ER, and you really don't pay attention to these things.
That's right.
And anyway, I was upset, and she just calmed down. I said, no, this is it. I am upset. And nothing you can say, Mother, is going to change my mind. She says, well, I really think you need to cool down. I said, well, nope, that's it. At that point, we heard a voice walk by, and it just asked in a real deep voice, where did you leave Ben? And we didn't pay any attention to it until we walked about 2 feet. And then my mom and I looked at each other, and we turned around together, and we saw a tall, almost Frankenstein stature man and a short man. And they both had on those white gowns, and their skin was gray tone. Mm. And we both looked at it, and then I kept looking at it, and then the tall guy turns around in like a Frankenstein stance and looks directly into my eyes. And he lifts his head up just a bit, like telling me, you know, I'm going to get you because you're vulnerable, because you can be mine. And then he just turns around and he walks off with the other short guy. And we both looked at them, and their skin tone was like, it was gray, as if they were had been dead for years. And then I looked at my mom, and she looks at me, and she says, make the sign of the cross. You know, we both made the sign of the cross. And she says, look, when you're this upset with somebody, the evil spirits know that you're vulnerable. And at this point, she says, you need to cool down, because this is how bad things happen.
Well, I'll bet you if her first speech didn't work, this one did.
Yeah, well, I still haven't forgiven him, but...
You did calm down.
Oh, yeah, I did calm down. And there are, I just want to tell everybody that there are bad spirits out there.
Yes.
And that when you're being negative and you're vulnerable and you don't have the fear of Christ or something that's more powerful than them, then they can get you. But if you have, if you can say a prayer now and then.
It's a matter of weakness.
It's a matter of weakness, like you were saying. It's a matter of weakness, and they'll come right on in, and this is how bad things happen.
It's such a good point. Thank you. Even if I were to relate it to what I do, and on this program, we talk about a million things. This is like any other, not like any other program you've ever heard. We delve into areas that are there really is no explanation for it. I can't put it into words. You're just going to have to listen to the program, not just this one, but the one we do on a regular basis, and you'll begin to get the idea. We don't bore in. We're not like other talk shows. We don't bore in only on politics or anything else. We do whatever comes up on any given night. And occasionally, we'll be in the political arena, or we'll be talking about something very terrestrial. And somebody will push my button. Now, in latter years, I've tried to let it happen less and less, but my button can be pushed. And there have been, over the years, a few times, mind you, a few times, when I have virtually lost it. I mean, I have become red-faced, heart-pounding, totally out of it, angry, and just totally blew up on the air. It does not happen very frequently, but it has occurred. Now, let me tell you, when that does occur, folks, as this lady just said, in my opinion, these are very, very vulnerable moments. And it's possible that if there is something close, something waiting for you, you are vulnerable. And it could take you in an instant. You don't believe it? That's fine. Just heed my warning. You're listening to Ghost to Ghost AM. From the great American Southwest and the high desert, I'm Art Bell. We'll be right back.
Call Art Bell toll-free, west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255, 1-800-618-8255, east of the Rockies at 1-800-825-5033, 1-800-825-5033. This is the CBC Radio Network.
From the great American Southwest, I bid you good morning. This is Ghost to Ghost AM. A lot of new radio stations joining us this morning. WJR Detroit, WHAM Rochester, New York. Both of them monsters covering large segments of the entire country. Also WFMD Frederick, Maryland, touching parts of Baltimore and Washington, D.C. As well, WTAD Quincy, Illinois. Welcome to all of you. Welcome to, well, I don't know. There never is a norm on this show, but if there is, this is not it. We're telling ghost stories. Tonight, maybe tomorrow night. I don't know. We'll see how it goes. We've had some buttes already. If you're just joining us, sorry, you've missed some buttes. We'll get back to it all in just a moment. Now, you know I love bringing you new junk. Oh, well, I shouldn't call it junk, should I? My wife calls it junk. She calls everything I like junk. Radios, I love them. She calls them junk. New stuff, how about that? Select Comfort is new stuff. It is a bed as no other. It has no springs. It has no sloshing water. It has only air pockets inside of it. And they will either get stiffer or slacken at your electronic command. Got a little electronic control over on your side of the bed, so does she. And you can adjust this bed to make it any way you want on any given night. So you wake up in the morning without aches, pains, and hurts. Now, we don't expect you to buy the bed. Sight unseen. Actually, from the outside, it looks like any other bed in the world. Inside, vive la différence. I guess that's still okay to say in all parts of Canada, huh? Now look, we'll send you a videotape, and it will show you all about this bed. Then and only then, if you decide you want to buy it, you get a 90-day exclusive in-home, or night trial, whatever, risk-free. In other words, look, they won't be able to if they came to take that bed back from you, you'd guard it with a shotgun. Believe me. The number to call for Select Comfort for the videotape, which is free, is 1-800-448-5700. That's 1-800-448-5700. In a moment, more Ghost to Ghost AM. The secret of making money is the right time. Now is the time to call the number I'm about to give you. Vice President Albert Gore said one thing just right, quote, make no mistake about it. The telecommunications industry is by all odds the most important lucrative marketplace of the 21st century, end quote. Act now. Discover how a minimum $7,700 participation in telecommunications right now could bring back to you $20,000, $30,000, $40,000 and more, plus a yearly income for the rest of your life. And yes, it can be part of your IRA or retirement plan. For complete details and a free video cassette, call them now, toll free, 1-800-444-1049. Ensure your financial future. Take action now, 24 hours a day, that means now, 1-800-444-1049. For a free investor's report and a video, call 1-800-444-1049. This is from a retired Navy fellow. Art, you had a show about airplane ghosts. Well, here's one about ship ghosts. I am retired, U.S. Coast Guard. I served on the icebreaker Glacier with a ghost. I saw him only one time. I was asleep in my stateroom when I heard a knock at the door. The door opened, and a sailor, that's in quotes, leaned in and said, Mr. Blank, you're needed in B1 engineering room. One of the mains is making bad noises, and the watch needs you. Got to the engine room fast as I could. The door opened as I got there, and one of the sailors said, I was just coming to get you. I told him I came as soon as I was called. His reply was, huh? This just happened, and I was just coming to get you. Another time I saw the hatch to the emergency diesel generator room close, and the lock wheel spin and lock. On entering the compartment, there was no one there. It's a small area with no place for anyone human to hide. The third time the ghost made himself known was to a woman who worked for the district office. She was updating blueprints while we were moored in Long Beach. Suddenly, he burst into the mess hall, so scared she was shaking. She told us she had seen a translucent, transparent sailor walk out of a bulkhead of the passageway, glare at her, continue on down the hall. She never came back on that ship. Jim, U.S. Coast Guard, retired. Shelton, Washington. Thank you, Jim. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Welcome.
Hi, Art. This is Jamie calling from Houston, Texas.
How you doing, Jamie?
I'm just fine. I'm a first-time caller, and I want to say that I've personally never seen a ghost, but the story I wanted to tell you has been in the family over 90 years, so I thought I might tell you. It's coming from three generations.
You might tell me.
Yeah.
All right.
Well, my grandmother used to tell me, but her grandmother told her when she was a girl, her uncle, her mother's brother, his wife died after they had had a new baby, and he had a little girl that was 6 years old,
right.
And then they had a new baby. Well, when he would get the little girl and the baby bedded down at night, you know, there were no electric lights. It was just old shacks in South Carolina. He would go out late at night, you know, for a couple of hours, you know, but he would leave a fire burning in the fireplace.
Sure.
Well, one night he went out, and he didn't come back. He stayed out a little late, and the baby started to cry. And the little girl, being 6 years old, she was afraid because the fire was burning out. She was afraid to get up. So after a while, the baby cried and cried. After a while, she heard this thump, and then something came down the fireplace. So the little girl said it looked like a big bird, and the bird stood right in front of the fireplace. And it started fanning its wings. And the fire just rose up, and she could hear a voice saying, get up and give Mama's baby some water. She couldn't see the face of the bird. She could only see the back, but she knew that was her mother's voice. So she walked around the bird and got the baby some water. When the baby was back down, the bird went back up into the fireplace just like it came, and the fire burnt real high all night long. And the little girl was telling her father about this big bird that came down the fireplace and told her to get up and give Mama's baby some water. So when he told his mother, which is my grandmother's grandmother, my grandmother's 85 now, she told him never leave the children alone anymore. But it was just amazing how something good, I guess we could call it a ghost or whatever, but the mother just wanted her to get a baby some water, you know, little girl like that.
Well, I suspect in the spirit world there is good and there's evil.
Sure. And I just thought I wanted to share that with you because that's not evil. It was a good thing.
I appreciate it.
And my grandmother's handed it down, and I suppose when my son gets old and has grandchildren, I'll hand it down to him. But thank you, Art, for having me.
Thank you. All right, I'm glad. Thank you. That's KTRH Houston. Now, I agree with that lady. There's good and there's evil. How many of you saw a movie called The Stand? Her bird story reminded me of this. In The Stand was a wonderful movie. The first hour of it is possibly some of the best I've ever seen. It kind of deteriorated, in my view, after that, the television version. But in The Stand, you may recall the large, black, evil bird. Well, I broadcast, for those of you who are just joining us, from my home, here in the middle of the desert, in the middle of nowhere, in a little town called Pahrump, Nevada. Laugh, if you will. At any rate, our town is famous for many things, but one of them is big black birds. And the movie they used, the bird they used for the movie, The Stand, came from right here in Pahrump. And those birds are all around me. So these are some of the biggest, but these birds are big enough to carry cats off. You don't mess with the birds out here. I don't know why they're so common to this area, but they're here. Big, big birds. Birds so big that if you can get near them and they begin to take off, their wingspan, well, as they begin to beat their wings to get their big bodies in the air, you can feel the draft. They are that big. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hi.
Hi, Art. How are you?
Okay. Where are you?
I'm in Reno right now.
Reno, KOH.
That's right. This story happened to me, I would say it was 91, 92. I don't remember the exact date. I was living in Guam.
Guam?
And I was at a friend's house, and he was on his way out of the door. I'd just shown up, and he's like, well, hey, look, I'm going to a rosary, which is really common out there. It's very, very Catholic, and it's kind of like the remembrance of their loved ones that have passed away.
Sure.
He's like, look, I'm on the way to this rosary. How about this? Come with me. We'll keep that way. It'll keep it real short. We'll just stop in. We'll, you know, say hello, blah, 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 whatever, pay our respects, and then we'll take off.
Right.
Well, we get there. Everything's kind of fine. You know, everybody's kind of just mellow, and it's mostly just the immediate family of this guy that had passed away.
Yes.
And it was a guy that my friend had went to school with. And so we're standing there, and the guy that died's little sister came in. She was about maybe 4 or 5 years old, crying. She comes running from down the hall, and I don't remember the dead guy's name, but I'll just say David. She was crying, and her mother's like, what's the matter, hon? Mm. And she's like, well, David's here. And she was like, I don't want to hear that. Just kind of calm down. She's like, Mommy, David's here. He's here. And the grandmother said, look, just, you know, your mother doesn't need this right now.
Sure.
And so everything was fine for about 15 minutes. Next thing you know, she's standing there. She says, look, there he is. And we all just kind of stopped, and we're all looking down the hall, and there's nothing. And she's like, can't you see him? And we're like, no. And the grandmother by this time is getting a little irate, and the mother's pretty much crying pretty profusely, I guess, and it wasn't a really good scene at this time.
I've got you.
So everything kind of chilled out a while, and I'd say about 5 minutes passed. She walks down the hall, comes back, and she's just saying, look, David wants us in his room now. And, you know, just to kind of humor her, I guess, the grandmother told my friend to go in the room with her.
Sure.
And also, her older brother, the one like that was older than the one that had died. So I just followed, just, you know, because, I don't know, it's kind of like one of those little horror movies, I guess. You want to know what's going on. So I followed him into the room, and she's, like, pointing to these I guess they're cupboards or whatever, but they're kind of like sliding doors above the bed. And they're about 6 feet up in the air. And she's like, he wants us to open those. So my friend goes over to open it, and he can't make it budge. He cannot make this little door to this cupboard slide over. So he asked me to help him. And I get up there, and I'm not a little guy. I'm about 200 pounds and about 6 foot.
Right.
And I was budging and just pulling and pushing, and we tried everything to get this open. There's two of us, and we couldn't do it. And, you know, I'm starting to get a little, not really upset, but just aggravated.
Sure.
And she's, you know, starting to cry again, saying, do it, do it, do it. And so the mother walks in, and she's like, you know, calm down, calm down. Well, she said, and then the little girl said, no, he wants me to open it. So my friend picked her up, and she slid it open with not even a budge. It was just like she could have used her pinky.
Yeah.
And in there were a bunch of personal artifacts and pictures, and the first thing that they pulled out was a letter that he had written to his little sister in case something had ever happened to her.
Oh, my God.
And it was the scariest thing. I mean, yeah.
Well, I listen, thank you very much for the story. I can't tell you how much I appreciate it. That, though, is typical. And there are two things I would take from that. One, again, a person who has died coming back to give a message that must be given, something that must be released from that spirit before it is released. But the other aspect of that story that I find intriguing is that I believe that children, little children, have more of an ability to see, experience, or touch the other side than we do. Now, I wouldn't pretend to be able to tell you why, and there are adult sensitives, certainly, who have either maintained or nurtured that ability to see or reach or talk to the other side. But children, in their innocence, I think, have something that the rest of us begin to lose as we get older because of the noise of society, the noise level, the signal-to-noise level, if you will. It was a deep thing that is either in all of us or was once in all of us or is still in all of us that fades. But, you know, in children, it has not yet faded. So children have a unique kind of sensory ability the rest of us do not have. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Good morning.
How you doing, Art?
Okay, where are you?
I'm in Canton, Michigan, which is just west of Detroit.
Excellent. WJR, I bet.
You betcha.
All right.
I just want to tell you about a really scary ghost story that involves my brother. This is back in 1983, October 7th.
Yes, sir.
And,
you remember the date that well, huh?
Well, I sure do, because, I was on the road. I was playing with a band in Saginaw, Michigan.
Ah, yes.
I was playing at the Fortney Hotel. And, I finished the job about 2:30 in the morning, and I went up, and I had a couple of beers, and I laid down, and all of a sudden, you know, I woke up and I was at the top of the stairs. We were staying on the second floor of the hotel.
Mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden I felt an arm around me, and it was like I heard a, hey, brother, go back to your room. You got to go to sleep.
Hmm.
Well, all of a sudden the next night I got a call from my mother that my brother had committed suicide and he had died 2 days earlier on the 6th.
Oh, boy. Any other visits, or was that it?
No, he visited me for about the next week and a half.
He did?
Yes.
And talked with you?
It was like I could feel a cold stare over me.
A presence.
Yes.
Not unusual. Again, really typical.
It was very strange.
People pass, and yet, for some reason, they don't quite pass. They're not quite ready. And I guess that was the case with your brother. Now, I'm curious. Were you comforted by that, or frightened by it?
I was comforted very much.
Did it change you?
Yeah, I think it did.
I mean, does it tell you there is an afterlife?
Yes, it does.
Yeah. Yeah. I sure do appreciate your story and your call. Thank you. You know, that is what it's all about, the search. Now, how are we to know there really is another side? Well, he knows. Other people who have experienced things like that, they know. And I may know something, but I don't want to talk about it. I'll let you do the talking. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Good morning.
Well, how art thou, Grandmaster of all Nye County?
Well, thou art fine if you would turn your radio off.
Okay, I sure did. Sorry about that, Art.
Sorry. Where are you?
I'm calling from Fresno, California, and I'm on KMJ 580.
That's the one.
You got it. I want to say one thing. I really enjoy your show, and I enjoy Dreamland immensely.
Thank you. It is a different kind of program.
Well, it certainly is. I think I have nightmares every Sunday night. Well, anyway, if I may relate a story to your audience, I don't know if it's necessarily a ghost story, but I always thought it was spooky, and I always think of it from time to time, and I tell people. Well, one Saturday morning, it was back in 1988, it was 2 weeks before I was going to go out of town. That's how I remember. I started to wake up on a Saturday morning. All of a sudden, this blue light shined. It was like a blue light shined inside of my head.
Wait a minute. Inside of your head?
Yeah, it's like a TV. All of a sudden, a TV or an image flickers inside of my head.
Okay.
And then from here, get a load of this. I saw it was like these people, like in a large or a fairly good-sized underground cavern or hallway or room.
Really?
And it was just swathed or bathed in blue light. There was four of them. They were tall. They had, like, jeweled masks on and robes, and I had the feeling that the ones in the black were women, and their hair was, like, kind of longish and black, and then the men had gray robes, and their skin was, like, white, 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 like Mickey Mouse. And it lasted for about 30 seconds. And then from time to time, I think of it maybe it's symbolic of something or what. But I'll tell you, I was sure startled, but I think subsequently I've told people about it, and they said, well, maybe there's a symbol there. Or,
what would you call that, a vision?
I don't know, but for a moment, since then I haven't had something like this. But ironically, I'd been thinking that before I went to sleep how we can possibly communicate with our ancestors psychically, and I don't know if it's a possibility.
Why do you think they were your ancestors?
Well, I mean, I got to thinking about that subject by coincidental. I don't think that they are, but I got the feeling they're from overseas. I don't know if that's of any importance.
Maybe. All right. Thank you very much. Maybe what happened is you just sort of crossed psychic paths for a few moments with somebody who was doing some kind of experiment somewhere else, or somebody else who was dabbling in areas they perhaps should not have been, and you were simply the receptor for that tampering. Now, that's an absolute stab in the dark for somebody who is simply a talk show host and listened to your story. I don't have the slightest idea what it was. But, if you'd had a couple, it certainly would sober you up, wouldn't it? We'll be back. There'll be more. This is Ghost to Ghost AM.
Kingdom of Nye, you're hearing Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell on the CBC Radio Network.
Black and orange stray cats sitting on the fence. Ain't got enough
with my tail in the air.
Actually, everybody, this is Ghost to Ghost AM. Good morning. I'm Art Bell. We're telling ghost stories tonight, maybe tomorrow night. Oh, and they're weird. Very weird. Take this one, for example. Art, as soon as you suggested we turn down the lights if we dare, the lights in my room dimmed by half. As I write this, there is still dim. Oh, that's weird. Really weird. This is the night for weird. Then this. Hi, Art. Great show. First off, in my 35 years, I have never encountered anything of a strange nature before. That is, until just recently. I'll let you decide if this is a ghost story or not. But I'm now convinced. I've been living at an apartment complex for about 2.5 years. I work nights, therefore I sleep in the day. Figures, I do too. After a few months after moving into my apartment, I'd be awakened from a sound sleep by the feeling that someone was in bed with me. It was as though someone was thrashing wildly about the bed. But when I looked at the bed, it was as empty as was the bedroom. This happened every day during the month of September and stopped after September 21st. I thought it was just a sleep disorder. Since it seemed to have disappeared, I soon forgot it. Then, the following September, the same thing happened. And just as before, it stopped after the 21st. I went to my doctor. I discussed it with him, and he gave me some pills. Anyway, last month, it began again, and the pills did not work. As the 21st approached, the thrashing feeling would be more intense and last longer to the point where I could no longer get any sleep. Now, after 2 days of no sleep, I came home from work, and a neighbor, who I've been having a passing acquaintance with, noticed my haggard look. He asked me if I was sick. I told him that I wasn't getting much sleep lately. One thing led to another, and before I knew it, I told him of my strange tale, but I left out the thing about it only happening during the month of September. Now, this guy has lived at this complex for 15 years, and here's what he told me. Quote, I often wondered why no one stayed for very long in your unit. Now I think I know. Back in September of 1981, a young lady lived in your apartment, and later that month was found dead on her bed. The autopsy showed that she had been strangled and put up one hell of a fight. End quote. Now I believe the thrashing about my bed is the spirit of this lady. Another thing that's strange is that it only happens during the day, not the night. Therefore, I feel she must have died during the day. What do you think? What should I do? Jim, in Phoenix, Arizona. Buddy, I wouldn't begin to try to tell you what to do. I don't know. More Ghost to Ghost AM in just a moment. I call it that. Normally, the name of the show, by the way, is Coast to Coast AM. But tonight, and maybe a bit of tomorrow night, it's Ghost to Ghost. Many of you health-conscious folks are familiar with antioxidants and their amazing health benefits. Now, vitamin C is probably the most famous of these. UCLA scientists found that antioxidant vitamin C can help avoid cancers, strokes, heart attacks, increase life expectancy an average of 5 years. Well, now, there are new antioxidants on the market. And listen, scientists say they are 20 times more powerful than vitamin C and 50 times the power of vitamin E, another antioxidant. They're called pycnogenols, the super antioxidants. You want to remember that if you're a health-conscious individual. Why? Well, according to Richard Passwater, Ph.D. and authority in the field, you're being bombarded by something called free radicals, toxins, environmental and otherwise, that break down cells damaged tissue, cause you to age faster, develop stiff joints, and wrinkles sooner than you ought to. How can you fight these free radicals that bombard you every day? Antioxidants and pycnogenols are the most effective antioxidant you can buy today. To order this amazing new food supplement I'm taking, call the folks at Health Naturally at 1-800-856-1119. These pycnogenols are pharmaceutical grade, made from 95% pure grapeseed extract. It's the very purest on the market, giving you the most benefits. Call 1-800-856-1119. That's 1-800-856-1119. One other note, then it's back to the stories. It involves absolutely fresh flowers. This is a company in Southern California that sends only good spirits, emotions, love, feeling, caring. And they send them directly to you or to the person you want them to go to the next day. Here's the deal. It's a flower farm. They sell flowers to you minus the cost of getting them there at the wholesale rate. So when you call the flower farm, they actually go out, cut the flowers, pack them up in this big triangular box, and they go off next day by FedEx. So you call today. The flowers are delivered during the week tomorrow. Pretty good, huh? Or if you've got a birthday or anniversary coming up and you want to settle your mind now, you can call, and for $39.95, you get this incredible shipment of flowers and miniature carnations. Every color of the rainbow, you get a little card with your message, your name, flower, preservative, and delivery, all for $39.95. Try and beat that anywhere. The number to call 24 hours a day is 1-800-562-6438. Let me give that one more time. 1-800-562-6438. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Good morning. Where are you calling from, please?
Houston, Alaska.
Houston, Alaska.
Right.
All right. Welcome to the show.
Thanks. My name's Linda.
Hi, Linda.
And let me tell you first that I was born on Friday the 13th. And this story that I'm going to tell you happened to me 35 years ago when I was 13.
Oh.
In a place called Westfield, Massachusetts.
All right.
And at 13, I went to a public school there. And at 13, I had a crush on a boy that went to Catholic school. And I talked a couple of my friends in on a Monday night to go to see him after catechism got out.
Ah, yes.
And we had a curfew time we had to be home. And we knew we were going to be late. So my friends, which was kitty corner to the church, was an old cemetery. And it had the wrought iron and the stone wall.
Oh,
and,
yes.
As a child, I don't remember it ever being used, but it was an old cemetery. It was pretty shut down. And my friends talked me into going through the cemetery to take a shortcut home. So I was always a tomboy and wasn't afraid of anything. So we took off through the cemetery running. And halfway through the cemetery...
Well, if you weren't afraid, then why were you running?
Well, we had a deadline to get home.
I've got you. All right.
Okay. We took off running through the cemetery... And halfway through the cemetery, I fell through the ground.
I beg your pardon?
I fell through the ground.
Through the ground. In
into
other words,
a
you'd,
hole which I assumed was a grave.
A grave, yeah, right.
And the dirt came in down alongside around me.
Oh, boy.
And I was screaming. I had bugs that I assumed were termites. They had wings on them that were I was covered with.
Oh, my God.
And... At that time, as 13 years old, I was only about 5'1".
Mm.
I didn't know how I was going to get out of here. I remember screaming.
Mm.
And I felt something around my feet, a pressure, not any, nothing, you know, that was grabbing onto me, but some kind of pressure that lifted me up out of that dirt. And I was at a dead run, and I didn't stop until I got to the other side of the cemetery. And my friends were there, and I was covered with dirt, and I was covered with all these... which I assume probably were termite bugs that were all over me. And I never, to this day, have been in a cemetery. I'm 48 years old, and I've never been back in a cemetery to this day.
I cannot say I blame you. That, to me, would be the end of me, dear, because I would have a heart attack right
on the spot. That was very scary.
Fortunately, your heart was young enough to take it, I guess.
Right.
Great story. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Take care from Alaska. Oh, man. Can you imagine running across a cemetery in the dark, falling into a grave with bugs crawling all over you? I remember, you remember Poltergeist? I don't know, it's etched into my memory. Do you remember at the end when the graves began popping up and they fell into the pool? Do you remember that? And the skeletons and the sort of half fleshy, half non-fleshy things began popping up in the pool. I wouldn't make it through that. I wouldn't even begin to make it through that. I'd turn around in that mucky water and look at one of those flabbing flesh things, and I'd have my heart attack on the spot. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Good morning.
Hello, Art.
Hello, where are you?
Austin, Texas.
Austin, welcome.
Yes, I'm calling about a story that if my family finds out I'm telling this, I'm going to be in big trouble, but it occurred in Louisiana about 100 years ago, and it's still occurring to this day.
Oh.
It's a 100-year-old ghost story that occurred originally in Cachette, Louisiana, and I had an aunt and uncle that lived 100 years ago, several generations removed, and they were recently married, and my aunt died shortly after the marriage, and the uncle was completely devastated. And when he was going to bury his wife, she was in her 20s. They hadn't been married for a year. He had the coffin ordered from New Orleans. He wanted a special coffin. He wanted a glass coffin. And he wanted her buried in Metairie Cemetery in New Orleans.
Metairie. Mm-hmm.
And he was told that it would take 6 months for the coffin to be ordered. And so in order, he waited for the coffin to come up to Shreveport, up to his area. And he would keep the corpse upstairs in his house. In the bedroom, and according to the servants at the house, he would kiss the corpse every night before he would go to bed.
Oh, boy.
The servant said that, he would order them to take the corpse out every day and air the corpse out in a barrel and for 6 months. And he had a Ouija board, as you were talking about earlier.
Yes.
A Ouija board, the servant said he would talk to the corpse every night and have conversations, and apparently this was a jealous ghost, and the servants were horrified. They would not clean this room. They said that candles wouldn't light when they went up there. There was cold air. The candles would blow out. They could hear low-level whispers, and they said objects would fall from the room. And at night, they would, after a while, after a certain point, they would hear conversations between my uncle and
the
some
corpse.
Other voice.
Some other voice, the corpse, I presume. Oh, my.
And as I say, no one would go into this room for many years. Eventually, the glass coffin did arrive. They did bury her in Metairie Cemetery in New Orleans. She's still there to this day in the crypt, and
did that end it?
No, because up until the 1970s, all of my relatives who would go to visit this house would not visit that room. They still said that cold area was still there. They could still feel the presence. I remember going there as a child with my aunt. My aunt had shaky legs. She wouldn't even walk up the stairs. They could hear the squeaky wheels of the wheelbarrow at night of the wheelbarrow that was supposed to air out the corpse. They could still hear that in the 1960s and 70s. And there was a portrait that they couldn't photograph.
Is this something that your family will not talk about?
It's not something that they're proud of. but it is. Something that everyone knows about, and there is a certain member in the family who is a keeper of the key to the crypt, who does have a key to the
Would you go in there?
Yeah, I guess I would. Just out of curiosity, because it's been something I've heard about all my life, and I'm curious about it.
All right. Well, I listen, I very much appreciate your call, but there's no way that I would. There's no way. Absolutely no way. Now, you tell me, you explain to me, but that man is just like the women in the low-cut dresses who, the moment you hear the bump and the grind in the basement, immediately do what? They go down the stairs to the basement. The one place where you know they ought not go. Everybody knows evil things lurk in dark basements. But they go straight down there and see if that fellow had the key. Where would he go? He'd go look at the body. I know he would. I wouldn't. Would you? Listen, I want to, God, that was weird. I want to tell you two things. One, if you would like a copy, and we have over two more hours of this program yet to do, this is one program that we make available to the audience. If you would like a copy of the program you are listening to right now, you can call 1-800-917-4278. Let me give you that number again, because I know a lot of you are going to want it. It's 1-800-917-4278, and it is good now, 24 hours a day. It is the Ghost to Ghost Halloween show. One other little item. We know we're going on in a whole bunch of new affiliate areas this morning. Love to hear from you by fax. We do have a 24-hour-a-day fax service, which sounds pretty fancy. It's really just fax a machine in my living room. The number is area code 702-727-8499. Let me give that to you again. I'd love to hear from somebody in New York, confirming we're on way back in New York, Rochester. Area code 702-727-8499. West of the Rockies, you're on the air.
Well, hello, Art.
This hello.
Scott from Graham, Washington.
Hello, Scott.
And this is something that happened over on the west side of the Olympic Mountains.
Yes, sir.
And it's up the Queets River. Anyway, we were, there was four of us, and we had two pickup trucks and one camper on one truck. And we went up to this beautiful spot with the river, and on the other side of the river is a cliff with these just huge boulders, probably 5 to 1,000-pound boulders.
Big
just ones. Huge.
Big rocks.
Big rocks. And so we got up there, and it was dusk. And when it's dark up there, I mean, it is dark. I mean, you can't even see your hand in front of your face.
Understood.
And so we decided to sit all in one camper and have a good old poker game.
Mm-hmm.
So we were all sitting around playing poker, and it was about 1:30 a.m., and we heard some splashes in the river, and we heard some grunts.
Grunts.
Yeah, just kind of huge grunts. So we figured it was probably a bear out there having fun in the river, you know.
Don't like grunts.
Yeah, and so after a while, the grunts seemed to get louder, and we heard like big rocks hitting each other. You know how you can hear the crack of rocks?
Of course.
And after a while, these rocks seemed to get closer and closer to our camper. And you could feel the rocks hit the ground outside to kind of a big thud. And I'm telling you, we all looked at each other and we said, nobody's going outside. I mean, we were armed to the teeth, but we were scared to death.
I wouldn't. You mean like those gigantic rocks, you know, coming out of the air and hitting the ground like that?
Yes.
It's
just like
bad.
Somebody was over there throwing these huge rocks.
Uh-huh.
And then, you know, I wanted to call you last week about the Sasquatch sound, because you wouldn't believe this. I mean, the hair on the back of our necks was standing up. It's standing up now.
Was it like the sound I've got?
It was close, but not really. I mean,
we're closer to the first one that Linda Howe sent, or the second one?
The second one.
That,
and
you
these
mean
sounds...
That absolutely horrible, it was a, I don't know what I would call that. I would call that, it almost sounds human. To me, it sounded like a man in horrible, horrible agony. That's the only way I can think to put it. Is that about the way it sounded?
Oh, you wouldn't believe it, Art. It was just about like that, and it was echoing up and down the river, and it was terrible. We were terrified, and these rocks were, you could almost hear them whistling through the air, and they were crashing on the other side of our camper. They were hitting in the water, and the cracking of the rocks, and this went on, Art, for 3 hours. And what do you guys do?
You just sit there and sort of shake at the table,
well,
or what?
We're on the floor of the camper. We just couldn't move. We didn't know if one of these rocks are going
to
hit us.
Now, you see, that sounds realistic to me. That's where I'd be, floor of the camper. You betcha.
And we were armed to the teeth, let me tell you. And I was ready for anything. And this went on for 3 hours, and it was about like 4:30 in the morning, and the sun started coming up. And we're all looking at each other going, thank God.
Yeah.
Especially because I had to go to the bathroom. But anyway... And so we finally had enough nerve to go outside the door because the crashing and everything had stopped like about an hour before the sun came up.
See, I would have waited, too, for the crashing to stop and for the sun to come up. Okay, sounds good so far.
Okay, so we decided we'd go outside. And finally we opened up the door and we all got out. And I said, you guys get out here. You got to see this. And the other truck was just fine. But around our truck and the camper... were these huge boulders in a circle around the camper.
Oh, my God. I presume to this day you have no idea what it was.
No, but it had to be something...
Awfully big.
Awfully big. Because it took us pushing with one truck and pulling with another to get them far enough out of the way so we could get the truck and the camper out.
That's an incredible story. Do you swear... That's true.
Oh, yes. And this happened in 1975 because it's when I got out of the service and all four of us got together because we used to go on camping trips when we were in high school. And to this day, when we get together, I mean, this, you know, this is something we always talk about.
You still talk about. I can imagine you would. Well, that one is almost a topper. What an absolutely incredible story. And so that's where it ended. You hauled the rocks away, and that was it.
Yeah, we pushed them out of the way, and we got out of there. And
something.
I have never been up there again.
I can't blame you. Thank
you. I will not go.
Thank you very much for the story. Thank you,
sir.
Take care. Something that big with those kinds of rocks. No, thank you. This is Ghost to Ghost AM. I'm Art Bell. For some, we'll be right back.
Taking calls on the Wildcard Line at 702-727-1295. That's 702-727-1295. First-time callers can reach Art Bell at 702-727-1222. 702-727-1222. Now, here again, Art Bell.
Good morning. It's Halloween all across America. And we are doing what we do every Halloween. We're doing ghost to ghost. If you've got a good ghost story, we're here for you. But first, something that somebody should have thought of long, long, long ago. Leprina. You know what that is? It's aspirin. Well, that's not magic. Aspirin's been around for... But wait a minute. You don't have to take Leprina, in fact, you shouldn't, by mouth. It's not even in tablet form. This is spray-on aspirin. Now, you say, well, what do you mean spray-on? Well, aspirin, normally you take pills, right? You digest it. Digestive tract 101, we've talked about that. Gets into your bloodstream, and you have pain relief. Takes a long time, and is not very specific. Loprena, just like a nicotine patch that you put on your arm, you know, puts nicotine into your bloodstream. Loprena, you spray on your skin. Say you got a sore knee, sore shoulder. You spray it directly on the area where you want the miracle. Ladies and gentlemen, aspirin does not need to be taken orally. It can be sprayed on. That's what Loprena is. The people who use it, I'm one of them, say it is damn near miraculous. It is. Call them. If you want Loprena, call them. It is Health Naturally that sells it, naturally. And the number is 1-800-308-4565. That's 1-800-308-4565. And if you ask them, they will tell you a way to get Loprena at a very low rate indeed. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Good morning. No, I think we just missed that person. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Good morning.
Yes. I have a ghost story for you.
All right. All ears. Where are you?
I'm in Pasco, Washington.
Okay.
I was camping earlier this summer with a friend up in the mountains. There was actually three of us. We went up.
Another camping story. Did you hear the last one?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man.
Well, not that bizarre, actually. We were up in the mountains, probably 20 miles from the nearest town and 10 miles from the nearest person.
Yes.
Way out on a logging road up in a clear cut. Someplace we used to go, you know, just for the weekend or something where nobody would be around. And
sure.
We were up there, and me and this girl went walking down the road, and my friend was sitting up by the campfire, and we come back about 10, 15 minutes later, and he's in the car hiding. I don't know, he's probably got tired and went to sleep.
Yeah.
He gets out of the car and goes, who is the guy that just came by? And I looked at him and said, get real, man. We're 10 miles from the nearest person. Who the heck could come up here?
Right.
He said, some guy in a black robe comes by, looks at him and says, this isn't right. And just walks off.
Meaning, he thought, what? This isn't right that you are here?
That's what neither one of us could understand, because he'd never been there before. In the road that I was on, they had clear-cut it in another direction, so the road was almost grown over, and I remembered where it was. You know, it was one of the roads that trees had now come up in the middle of.
Right.
And we had no idea what the heck he was talking about, and he just kept going on. Somebody came by and said, this isn't right. And he just kept going on and on. So finally we just left because he was just going ecstatic about it.
That's weird, all right. That's very weird, and so you just never found out anything more about this?
Every time I talk to the guy, he still goes on about this. He still thinks I had somebody up there with us. But where we were, it was impossible for anybody to have found us. I mean, you know, it was one of those places, if you were to get hurt or something, nobody would find you.
Well, I guess that's one of those things you're going to have to wonder about your whole life, huh?
Apparently. I have another quick one, if you don't mind.
Very quickly, yes.
I worked in a plant up in a little city up north of here called Lake Stevens. Actually, it's on the other side of the mountains from us.
Right.
And I was in working one night. It was a Prestolog plant, and it was very noisy, so you wear earplugs.
Mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden, I heard somebody call my voice. There was only two of us that worked in the plant, so I figured it was the other guy. And he was out on the forklift outside, so I went outside. And as I'm going out, he's coming in and said, what did you want? There was nobody around. He said the plant had been doing it ever since they had built the plant. It's done that. One person will hear somebody call the name, and the other person will come in as the other person's going to look for the other one. But nobody could figure it out.
Well, it's just, it's in line. Thank you very much for the story. It's exactly the kind of thing we're talking about. Art. My father died of cancer in the summer of 1992. Now, I'm in the Navy, was stationed in Maryland at the time. I knew he was ill, but the cancer spread to his spine unexpectedly and caused him to become incapacitated literally overnight. My wife and I had to travel to the hospital in Florida. He was so incoherent by then that I never got a chance to speak to him one last time. He died a few days after our arrival. moments before we got to the hospital on that particular day. After paying my respects and comforting my mom, my wife and I left the hospital. We entered an elevator that was going down to the lower parking area. Suddenly, the elevator began going up and stopped on the next floor. The door opened, but there was no one in sight. Also, there were no stairs that anyone could have exited by. The doors began to close and then opened abruptly as if someone were blocking the entrance. This happened several times until my wife finally said, "Okay, Preston, knock it off." The doors closed, the elevator took us to our desired floor. I feel this was simply an attempt by my father to let me know that he was there, that he was okay. Just thought you'd enjoy the story. Thanks. James in Honolulu, Hawaii. There you are. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Good morning.
How you doing, Art?
Okay.
I've been trying to get a hold of you all night.
Where are you?
I'm in Cape Girardeau, Missouri, listening on KZIM.
Oh, that's right. You're on a portable phone, too, aren't you?
Cordless phone, yeah.
Yep. Do you have a regular one?
No, I don't.
You don't. All right. Well, we'll put up with it. Go ahead.
Well, I've got a story that's really going to scare you and kind of scare me whenever I think about it. But I used to be in the Air Force, and I was stationed at F.E. Warren Air Force Base in Cheyenne, Wyoming.
Right.
And that's a really haunted base. If anybody knows about that base, they know what I'm talking about.
Haunted in what way?
Well, it used to be an old cavalry base. And there's been a lot of murders, a lot of cavalry murders, Indian murders, suicides, just stuff like that in the dormitories. And it's just a really haunted base. I mean, there's ghosts of dogs in the dorm that I used to live in.
Really?
Yeah, it was really scary. But I was going through some really rough times, and I just moved back into the dormitory, and I would every once in a while see this like dark cloud, like kind of like a gas cloud above my bed or down the hall. And then whenever I would look at it directly, it wouldn't be there anymore. And then I'd be getting dressed and taking care of my uniform, looking in the mirror and everything, and out of the corner of my eye, I'd see this face and these hands peeking at me around a corner. And I'd look, and nothing would be there. And the face was all black and had blue, kind of bluish eyes.
Dad.
I mean, dark blue, like a navy blue.
Uh-huh.
And, I mean, it was really scary. And then one night, I was missing home really bad, and I thought, well, my mom.
All right, sir, your phone is breaking up.
Okay, can you hear me better?
Yeah, that's better.
Okay.
Quit moving around.
All right, my mother is into the New Age stuff.
Yep.
She was telling me about a lot of the stuff she used to do, and I tried it once. I tried to go back home. She called it, like, astral projection. And I tried that. I didn't know how to do it, but I was laying down on my bed, and I was concentrating as hard as I could on home, and I felt myself sit up. But when I looked, I saw my body laying down, and I could see right through my legs. I could see through everything.
Ooh, that's weird.
Yeah, and then I saw a friend of mine come through the door and say, "Hey, Spence, get up. Are you coming with us?" And at that moment, it felt like I was sucked down into my body, and it scared me so bad I never tried it again.
I don't blame you. Thank you very much for the call. It was a terrible phone, but a good story. And I also believe that projection from the body, what he called astral projection, is possible. That if we, kind of like in some of the movies that I've seen, Somewhere in Time particularly, our mind is capable of many, many things, including possibly time travel and out-of-body travel. I'm not an expert. I simply listen to the stories. On our first-time caller line, you're on the air. Hello there.
Hello, Art.
Yes.
Oh, my name is Samantha.
Samantha, that's a good Halloween name.
Yeah, I know.
Where are you?
I'm in Las Vegas.
Wonderful. KVEG.
KVEG.
The Big 840.
I love it.
Excellent.
Yes. Yeah. Well, I just thought I'd tell you a few flower stories about my mother. She, one time I was talking to her, she died in 1982.
I'm sorry.
And she was talking to me about 1976 and on the phone, and she said, all of a sudden she's like, smell flowers. You know, these. She was very strong, like stock or carnation. And she says, that's the flower my sister Edith likes.
Yes.
And about an hour later, she got a call that Edith had died.
Huh.
Then, when my mother died, I, of course, got the flowers, and I've been getting them, every year or so. It's like a bubble around your head. And if you walk away from it, you don't smell it. And you walk back to where you were, you smell it.
So it's in place, and you have to walk into it, literally.
Yes, or I'll be sitting on the couch, reading or something, and all of a sudden it'll come around my head, and it's like a bubble. And it's sweet peas with my mother, because that was her flower. And if I walk away from it, it's gone. I go back, and it's there, and it'll last about 5 minutes.
Huh.
This has happened to two of my sons.
Energy.
Usually in doorways.
Uh-huh.
And you know, there's no... no flowers in the house, no perfume or anything. And you'll walk out of the doorway. My son said, what's that smell? And I said, well, walk back in the doorway and you'll find it again.
Huh.
And it's just her little visitation.
Well, I believe you. I surely do believe you, and I thank you for the call, and I'll tell you something. I've heard many stories that involve spirits of people and flowers. Flowers that have lived as long as a person lives, and flowers that have been healthy and thriving, and then the moment somebody dies, the flower, the bush, the tree dies. Is there some kind of sympathetic reaction? I don't know what you'd call it, but I have heard many, many such stories. In a world gone crazy, it's kind of nice to be able to relax, especially on a night like this. Put on some music and let it all go. That's what Higher Octave and their music does for me. And believe me, it'll do it for you, too. Right now, you're listening to Craig Shakiso's album, Acoustic Highway. But we've got a special for you. Craig Shakiso, Neil Sean, and, of course, Shaheen and Saper. It's just laid back, come get me kind of music. And these are pros. Craig, former lead guitarist with Jefferson Starship, 13 Golden Platinum albums, a Golden Globe Award, a Grammy, an Oscar nomination, not a lightweight. Remember the great prices they offered on the Cusco music? Well, listen to this. You get three terrific CDs for $39.95. Or if you'll settle for cassettes, $27.95, we'll get them on the way to you. And you're ordering directly from the music label itself, Higher Octave. The number to call, 1-800-562-8283. Mention my name, Art Bell. Give them a call, 1-800-562-8283. Higher Octave, the name for 21st century music. Hey, you don't have to put up with it. I know a lot of you do, but you don't have to. What am I talking about? Hard water. Hard water spots on glassware, windows in your car. That crusty ring in your toilet bowl. Hard to remove soap film on shower doors, frozen valves on faucets. Hard scale buildup in your water heater costing you extra money, about $275 a year, just to heat the water. Well, I don't have those problems. I've got GMX water conditioning in my home for over a year now. Three small units, easy to install, no maintenance, no electricity, no salt. That's right, no salt, no back flushing. Using magnetic technology, GMX conditions the water, eliminates hard water buildup, yet allows your water to maintain its healthy minerals, making it great to drink and wonderful for plants. How can you go wrong? For $600, you can treat your entire home, and the units come with an unconditional 90-day money-back guarantee and a lifetime warranty. You've got nothing to lose except that ugly white stuff. Call the folks at 1-800-4060-GMX. By the way, they're celebrating their second year on the Art Bell program, so if you order now, they'll send you a copy of my new book, absolutely free. Call 1-800-4060-GMX. Order today. That's 1-800-4060-GMX anytime, day or night. Little caveat there. The first printing of the book is sold out. They will indeed honor that, however. And the moment the second printing, which is underway right now, is available, your book will be on the way. First, let us go east of the Rockies. You're on the air. Hello.
Hey.
Hey.
Wanted to get in a plug for satellite, too, because if it weren't for satellite, I wouldn't be able to hear you right now.
You're in where? Where are you?
Gainesville, Georgia.
Gainesville, Georgia.
WDUN.
And we lose
you at 5 a.m. Eastern.
Well, that's when I guess they begin their morning show.
Yes, it is, and I'd much rather listen to you.
Well, that's very kind. we're on, I should tell people that, I guess. We're on F1, satellite F1.
Oh, well, they've changed it back to C1 now.
C1, F1, a satellite band, any other name. And transponder number 5,
mm-hmm.
And 5.8 audio. So there you are, everybody. So we're glad you have still got us. Do you have a story?
Yes, I do. In fact, I'm not sure just where to start, because the situation started with Ouija board, as you were talking about earlier. But the part I want to tell you about most occurred further on down, so I'll skip that.
All right.
I was my freshman year in a small southern college, and ran into a guy in the student center who started talking about witchcraft.
Yes.
And was telling us stuff and claimed to be a black witch and had me, you know, curious. And there were three others that were with us, that were with me a lot, that we were talking to him about it. And one day he wanted us to go with him that night to a black mass.
Mm.
And I was brought Protestant. I wasn't even sure what mass was. And my best friend, my roommate, had a test scheduled the next day, so she said she wasn't going to go. She had to study and had to get some sleep.
Well, the key word, of course, was black. There are masses and masses.
Yes, yes. And I don't know that I really believed that he was a witch. I thought that a lot of it, he was just, you know, trying to take advantage of gullible freshmen. And
so there was a curiosity factor.
Yeah. And sure. So we decided we were going to go. Mm-hmm. And this was back during the time when the dorms were locked at 11 o'clock and the women were not allowed to be out of the dorms and, you know,
yes.
Back in the dark ages. And so I chickened out at the last minute and decided I wasn't going to go, because if I'd gotten, you know, caught out of the dorm, I could have been expelled, and I'd worked too hard to get to college to take the risk.
Right.
And so we had planned to leave by different doors and meet outside, and I didn't go. And I, you know, felt really bad. I felt like I was being punished for something I hadn't done, because I wasn't able to participate.
Mm-hmm.
During the night, maybe 5 a.m., I'm not sure exactly, the fire alarm went off in the building. And it was an old building, and this happened periodically. And I wondered if maybe my friends had caused the alarm, somebody to set off the alarm for them to help cover getting back in.
Sure.
The next morning.
Sure.
So I, you know, threw on my raincoat. We always kept a raincoat and shoes handy because the alarm went off so frequently, and headed out the front door. I was watching for them as I went out, and I saw them coming back in. And they were ahead of me, and I tried to, you know, push through the crowd and catch up to them. And as they were they had gotten on the elevator, and just before the elevator closed, I got close enough to see them, and they were looking, you know, facing forward, and they were white as a sheet. They looked like, you know, some of the shock victims that you see sometimes on Red Cross disaster films.
Yes.
Walking around.
Yes.
And I didn't know what was going on, and so it was an old elevator, and it moved slow, so I went running on up the steps because I figured I could beat it up to third floor where their room was and, you know, catch them as they got off.
Yes.
Got started, and I was about halfway up, and I heard the alarm go off in the elevator. It had stalled between floors.
Oh, boy.
And what had happened, I found out later, is they had packed, like, 15 people, you know, just tight as they could pack them in there before the doors closed, and, like, the capacity of the elevator was around 8,000 pounds or something. I mean, 800 pounds. It was just a small elevator, and they just had really overloaded it, almost double.
Okay, we're almost out of time, so quickly, what happened?
Bottom line, there's a lot more. The bottom line with them is, I don't know where to go from this. When they finally got them, it took like 3 hours to get everybody out of the elevator, and my two friends were both in shock and were sedated, and their parents picked them up that day and took them home, and I didn't see them again. But there was a guy that disappeared that night also that we found out later. It took a few days. And the guy that I'd been talking to in the student center told me that he was going to turn up soon. And about 3 weeks later, we heard that his body had been found in the college lake. His neck, his throat had been cut, and it looked like his body had been drained of blood.
Oh, my God. All right. Well, look, we're going to have to leave it there because we're out of time. But that was pretty gory. A lot of bad stories seem to involve elevators, don't they?
Call Art Bell toll-free, west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255, 1-800-618-8255, east of the Rockies at 1-800-825-5033, 1-800-825-5033. This is the CBC Radio Network.
This is Ghost to Ghost, actually. Good morning, everybody. Is this not a fabulous rendition? You know what this is, don't you? No? It's painted black by the Rolling Stones. It's the London Symphony. In case you were curious. Hello, Art. I just recently found you for the first time on KABC 790 in Los Angeles, and I'm very glad to have done so. Great shows, thanks to you and KABC. From the time I was about 7 years old to 15, I used to have a recurring dream. Premonition? Maybe about once every couple of months. It would always end the same, with me sitting straight up in bed in cold sweats and scared so bad it's hard to describe. The dream always started with two guys in an old Jeep out in the desert, just cruising along. I can see the desert and the worn dirt road. I could feel the heat. I could hear the sounds as they're going down this old, totally deserted road. Everything's just fine. The Jeep begins to go up a long inclined hill. There are telephone poles along the left side of the road, and the road seems to be almost perfectly straight, stretching out behind, climbing with the slope in front. Up till here, everything's just fine. Then the Jeep crests the top of the hill, and I can never see anything that the two guys see. But what I do see is just their faces. Just sheer terror. Not fear, but something worse. Last time I would see that Jeep turn on its right side off the road about 20 feet, looking like it had been there for a long time. When I was 15, I went to school with a friend down to Salton Sea in California, the desert. Second day we were there, he said he wanted to show me some old abandoned building, so we took off in his grandfather's Jeep out what was called Power Line Road. Well, we were about an hour from the house. The road began to climb upward, power lines on the left. All at once, all that fear from the dreams came back like a tidal wave, and I began to freak. I'm yelling at Steve to stop the Jeep or I'm going to jump out. I was not going over the crest of that hill, no way. At first, he thought I was messing with him, but he realized I meant it. He stopped, and I told him about the dreams. He kind of laughed at them. But we turned around and never, ever went down that road again. I never had the dream again. But the hair on the back of my neck is standing up now the way it did that day. Dan in Los Angeles. I believe you, Dan. Let me tell you about something that is the product of the year. It is called Real Talk. Now, Real Talk is just a good AM/FM digital radio. AM and FM. It covers everything you want covered. It's got a good front end, receives weak signals. It has got 10 memory presets. It's got a built-in microphone. It has a sleep timer, 90 minutes. It's got batteries, or you can plug it in. And then it's got one very, very important feature. It's got a cassette deck built in, and guess what? You can record up to 3 hours on one side of a 90-minute cassette. This is the talk radio person's radio and recorder. And you can set it to record when you want to. So you can record my program or Rush's or anybody else's. 3 hours on one side of a 90. Amazing. Hottest product of the year. Want one? They're $139.95, and that means getting into your door, shipping included. Here's the number. 1-800, you can call at 7:30 in the morning. 1-800-522-8863. 1-800-522-8863, the C. Crane Company. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Hi, Art. Cameron in San Francisco, KSFO.
Hi, Cameron.
Well, I got a whole bunch of them, and I had to think about it, and I finally came up with the best one that I've experienced.
That's what I like.
Okay. Well, this one, did you ever see 2010?
Of course.
Well, you remember where that ghost is on the ship and he says that something's about to happen, something wonderful?
I do.
Well, this is that kind of story.
All right.
When I was about 20, I just became a father on accident, and I was sitting in a karaoke bar sulking. I wasn't drinking, but I was in the karaoke bar sulking.
Sulking, yeah.
Thing and my girlfriend walked in, and she's about 6 months pregnant, and I wasn't supposed to be out that night, and I just figured, you know, I got all this youth inside me, and I kind of realized at that point, you know, I was just...
So you were going to try to sing away your blues.
Yeah, I was going to sing away my blues. I was going to try and sing it all away. I just wanted to ignore, you know, the fact that, I guess it's time to grow up.
I hear you. I mean, it is very sobering when she walks in and you see the big belly and you realize...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm sitting there, and a few years before that, I made an oath, you know, and this was a spiritual mistake on my part. I swore on my father's grave that I would quit smoking, and I'm sitting here in front of my computer with a cigarette right now.
Uh-huh.
Well, I'm sitting in that bar, and then I got this strange feeling, right? That somebody was standing behind me. You know, when you get that feeling like you're being watched?
Right.
Well, I'm sitting there, and I get this strange feeling I'm standing behind me. And since then, I kind of think I got eyes in the back of my head, you know, and I could almost make out this figure watching me.
I know that feeling.
Yeah, I'm sure you do. Especially with all the phone calls you get, and who knows what might be standing behind you that comes through the phone lines like that one witch said.
You're absolutely right, yes. Don't remind me, please.
I won't. Well, at any rate, I'm standing there, and all of a sudden I feel these hands on my shoulder, and I knew, I just knew that it was my dad, and I could feel him standing there, putting his hands on my shoulder, going, "It's all right, son. You gotta grow up." And I could hear this little voice, and I swear to God, it was right through the music. I even remember the song was playing White Rabbit, and I heard this voice say, "It's okay, it's just okay." And then I felt this light behind me, and he went, and he just left. And it kind of brought me, you know, I've been listening to you talk about this God thing, how would God let himself be known? After that moment, I kind of think that we just know. If God was to come here, if we're these humans, we just know it was him. We wouldn't
have to wonder, huh?
Yeah. But
it's a good point.
Huh?
Yeah, I said it's a good point that people would just know.
Yeah, we got it in us. But since that day, every time I look at my daughter, and right now I'm getting chills up my spine. I can see him in her eyes. I can see him. I don't know if it's, you know, one of those reincarnation things or if it's, I don't know what it is, but I just get this eerie sense.
I understand.
Every time I look in her eyes, there's somebody I've known for years in there. But I don't know. I just thought I'd tell you about that one because it's my favorite.
I appreciate it, sir. And I appreciate your call. Thank you. I of course I know what you mean. And to look into your daughter's eyes and to see him. Well, that is one way we live on, isn't it? On the first-time caller line, you're on the air.
Hi, Art.
Hi.
I'm calling from Merced, KYOS.
Yes, indeed.
And mine's very short, and I don't know what if it was a ghost or a real person, but I was up in the Santa Cruz Mountains in a Volkswagen, and 1970s somewhere, and with my friend, and we were coming back from a place up in the Santa Cruz Mountains called the Chateau Liberté.
Yes.
And anyway, we're coming down these mountains, and they're all curvy and everything, and as we came down...
Probably Route 17, wasn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, matter of fact.
I know the road.
Oh, right, great. Well, you know, then it's all rocky at some areas on the side with all trees. I mean, it's all green and all that and trees. But anyway, it's a two-lane road, right? And we're coming along, and it's down one of the downhill ways. And there's this, we come in, and we're kind of talking, you know, a couple girls, and we're talking. And there's this man lying in the road on our side of the road, and he's lying in the road with his head on the white line, and he has on a suit that's like kind of checkered. It's not a, you know, a normal suit, but it's a suit.
Right.
And we just notice it very quickly. It's a checkered suit, and he's just lying there, and we dodge him at the last moment, and that's all we ever saw of him. You know, it was just a dodge of this man, but he was lying there, and he was smiling. He wasn't dead. He wasn't squished or anything. You know, he was just lying in the road, and we looked back, and we didn't, you know, you couldn't see in the dark, but he wasn't, you know, there wasn't a grimace on his face or any pain or anything. He was just lying in the middle of the road.
Well, you lie on the white line long enough, and you will be squished.
Well, absolutely. But there was headlights way in the distance behind us, and they didn't make a swerve or anything, so we didn't know. And there were one other really quick thing is my mother grew up in the hills of Virginia, and she told me lots of stories. They had many sisters, you know, and seven sisters. Anyway, they were coming home one night, and their mother through the woods, if you can imagine coming home through the woods at night, but they did it all the time then. And at any rate, they came in, and they were supposed to get home before dark, and they didn't. And there was a little creek-like thing that they had to jump over. And it was small enough to jump over. But when they jumped over, it was dark, and they were afraid of getting wet and getting in trouble. And as they jumped over, a match lit underneath of them out of the middle of the water. Yeah, there are many stories like that from them.
All right, thank you.
Thank you very much.
All right, take care. The one about the road, 17 is a rough highway. It's like Highway 1 in a lot of ways, though inland. And then there's Blood Alley up in San Jose. Roads where a lot of people have been killed tend to be roads that are haunted. It's not really a reach to understand why. People died there. Spirits, energy, linger on those roads. It's just the way it is. You don't believe? That's fine. But it is true, you know. You're listening to Coast AM, actually this night, called Ghost to Ghost. We'll be right back. Although we eat food every day, we take for granted the process that it goes through to become energy. We take it for granted, that is, until the old internal engine begins to have trouble, causing pain and discomfort. It is no joke. Did you know that most degenerative disease begins in the lower digestive tract as bad intestinal bacteria gets out of control? Here's the good news, though. experts say that most healing begins in the same place. And it starts with good bacteria. The good bacteria in your body is essential to health, energy, and a long life, not only because it breaks down your food, but because it kills the unhealthy bacteria. Unfortunately, there are many factors that kill your good bacteria as well. They leave you vulnerable. Things like stress, bad diet, alcohol, drugs, antibiotics, even basic aging. But, listen, you can fight back. Because now there's Natron's Healthy Trinity. Not one or two, but three unique products offered together for your convenience and for a healthy and long life. Natron's Healthy Trinity, Megadophilus, Bifidofactor, and Digestilock. They get rid of bad bacteria and add the good bacteria that keeps your engine running full force. Call 1-800-992-3323. That's 1-800-992-3323. I take it because it makes sense to take. It's that simple. Natron's Healthy Trinity. Call 1-800-992-3323. If you suffer from headaches, neck aches, sports injuries, low back discomfort, arthritis, rheumatism, bursitis, menstrual pain, joint pain, any kind of pain, let me tell you about Leprina. No more waiting for pain relievers to kick in. No more settling for alternative pain relievers just because your system is aspirin sensitive. Just spray on Leprina topical aspirin and enjoy soothing relief without side effect. It really is that easy. And it works. It actually penetrates the skin right down to where the pain is. Remember the name Leprina. That's Leprina. You're going to be hearing a lot about this remarkable product. Believe me. I've used Leprina on my bad back, and the fast-acting results are truly amazing. Spray it on, the pain's gone. Some pain sufferers are calling the almost instant results miraculous, but you cannot get it at your local drugstore. If you want fast-acting topical pain relief, just order Leprina by calling 1-800-308-4565. That's 1-800-308-4565. The truly reasonable cost is a bargain for this revolutionary new product. And when you call, be sure and ask the folks at Health Naturally how you can get Leprina at an even greater savings. Call 1-800-308-4565. Just spray it on and the pain is gone. All right, back to the lines we go. East of the Rockies, you're on the air, Ghost to Ghost AM.
All righty.
Where are you?
I am in Owensboro, Kentucky, listening to WMI.
It's a good place to be. Welcome.
Oh, thanks. Have you ever heard of a ghost fire?
A ghost fire?
Yeah.
Not exactly.
Our railway station here in Owensboro was converted into a pizza place, maybe.
Into a what?
A pizza.
a
restaurant.
Oh, I understand. Okay.
Into a restaurant.
Interesting.
And I worked there.
Uh-huh.
And there was this huge fireplace close to the kitchen. But it hadn't been used for years. There was no reason to. But you could hear the flames crackling in it and feel heat from it, but there wasn't anything there.
Oh, now, that's weird.
Now, have you ever heard of anything like that?
No,
I know it happened. Everybody that worked there knew it.
Did it happen?
But we could never come up with an explanation.
Did it happen frequently?
Yes.
I don't think I'd like that.
Well, it was a spooky old place.
It just every now and then happened, huh?
Yeah.
So you could go over near it and warm yourself by the invisible.
You could feel heat from it. You could hear the fire crackling, but you didn't see any fire. It was just there.
No, you're the first.
Well, good.
But okay. This is a place for firsts. I appreciate your story.
Okay.
Thank you. I have no idea what to say about that. No idea. The manifestations of whatever it is on the other side are nearly endless. You've heard how many tonight? How can you not wonder? As our scientists wonder about the 100 million planets that they say have inhabited intelligent life, How can you not wonder about the kind of stories you're hearing this morning? How can you not? First-time caller line, you're on the air. Hi.
Hi, Art.
Hello.
Finally, I got through. It's the seventh time.
Well, I'm glad you made it. Where are you?
Oh, I'm living in Reno, Nevada.
KOH.
I'm looking at my black cat right now.
I have two of them.
Yes, and my cat's name is Shadow. I've had him for 2 years.
You're kidding.
No, when I heard you had a Shadow, too, I said, oh, all right.
I do, and Shadow was so named because of Ghost.
Oh, I know. I know the whole story. I listen to you every night. I have for 4 years, every night.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. So is KOH, I'm sure.
Yeah. Now, I've got to tell you my quick, short story. I have a lot of stories. I lived in the house. I was like the Amityville Horror.
Oh, you did?
Yes. But that's a long story. But I got a short one. When I was in high school, late 50s, I had an old 49 Ford, and I was driving down one of the Reno streets with my girlfriend, and we were talking, but now we're quiet, and this beautiful classical music came on, mm-hmm. and it was very loud, and it was too loud. And I looked at her, I said, could you turn down the radio? And she says, yeah, that's loud. And she reached over, and she said, you don't have a radio. And I said, oh, right. And we never discussed it.
No, I can understand.
That reminds me of that fireplace story.
Yeah,
Type of thing.
It's kind of like that, isn't it? It's energy. It's energy from someplace else. It's a projection, or it's a time slip, or who knows what it is.
Right.
But it's something.
And Art, I wrote you a note. Oh, must have been a year ago when you first started fooling around with the Ouija board.
No, I wrote
to you at your home and told you, please don't fool with the Ouija board. And I don't think you remembered. You get so many letters and things.
I'll tell you, this Ouija board thing is something I will listen to stories, but I really won't talk about
it. Yeah, but about 6 months ago, you said Halloween, you would discuss it. And
well, I did.
But it must be really something. I would love to hear the story because I've got my own.
Well, if you want to briefly tell us yours, go ahead.
Oh, I wrote you a letter on it.
Well, yeah, I know, but
well,
now you're on the radio.
I was in Hawaii.
Yes.
And my husband was watching my friend and I play the Ouija board. And he decided to blindfold us.
Oh, the
and
interesting
we said, fine.
Move. Yeah, okay.
You know, because we were working it. We were really working it.
I understand.
And we're blindfolded. And suddenly the little planchette, that's what you call the little triangle
yes.
thing
yes.
you put your fingers on?
Yes.
Flew out. And I pulled a blindfold out, and I said, what'd you do, Bruce? You know, knock the thing? He said, no, I held a crucifix over it. Do you remember that story now?
I do, yes.
Yeah.
And, yes. And, you know, it's so serious.
It's very serious.
And people don't understand, and they think, oh, gee, let's have some fun. Let's play with a Ouija board. And I used to feel the same way.
I know, because I listen to your show, like I say, every night. I was really concerned about you. That's why I wrote you the note. I was really concerned. And
well, with good reason.
Yes, because I knew. But now you know, so.
You're correct. Now I know. Thank you.
Okay, Art.
Right, take care. There are a few things that I won't talk about. That really is one of them. And I really I'm giving you good advice here when I tell you don't play with Ouija boards. They're not toys. Oh, I didn't even know if they're sold anymore. I would imagine that occasionally you could find one somewhere. But if I were you, I wouldn't even go to look. I wouldn't even think about it if I were you. You're listening to a collection of real. Now you can hear the voices. Real stories of the supernatural. Ghost stories. Stories of other dimensions, other realities, other times. I'm not really sure what it is. I'm just sure that it is. We'll be right back.
Art Bell is taking calls on the Wildcard Line at 702-727-1295. That's 702-727-1295. First-time callers can reach Art Bell at 702-727-1222. 702-727-1222. Now, here again, Art Bell.
I can sure tell you how to send good spirits. Send flowers. You never mistake those for evil. You never mistake flowers for a bad message. It's always warmth, love, caring, feeling. And believe me, it works. Absolutely Fresh Flowers is the company of which I speak. They sell flowers to you directly from a flower farm. And you get more flowers than you can believe. Miniature carnations, every single color of the rainbow. If there's somebody in your family who's got a birthday or an anniversary or any special day at all, you can't go wrong. You call them, they go out and cut them right there at the farm, pack them up in a big triangular box, and they get delivered the next day by FedEx. Or on the day you specify, now think, is there somebody with a birthday or an anniversary coming up? You can take care of it right now. You can say, look, I want them delivered on such and such a date, and I guarantee they'll be there. And you'll just bowl them right over. Absolutely Fresh Flowers. The number to call right now or any time, write it down for heaven's sakes. People call me up, panic, trying to get the number. The number is 1-800-562-6438. That's 1-800-562-6438. It works. East of the Rockies, you're on Ghost to Ghost AM.
Good morning, Semper Paratus.
How you doing? Where are you calling from?
Jacksonville, Florida.
All right. Good to have you.
Hey, it's great to be here. I've been enjoying your ghost stories, and it's one of the few times I've been able to tune you in here and everything.
What station are you managing to get us on?
WOKV.
WOKV.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
And just like I said, I've been enjoying your ghost stories and everything, and then after hearing about that great icebreaker you were on, I was an ASM stationed in the Gulf of Mexico out of Houston.
Yes, sir.
And we've had I don't know whether to give you the Coast Guard's official version or our official version of some of the stuff we had seen back
you,
then.
You tell me what you know.
Okay, this was 1983, right there. We had several experiences of seeing what we termed as ghost ships. And it would never show up on the radar. But we would hear it from, you know, small boats, 41-footers and stuff, of seeing different, like, glowing three-masted type schooner-type ships. I guess what you would maybe call an old pirate-type ship, old, you know.
Sure.
Ship of the, maybe the Continental Navy-type stuff or whatever.
Sure.
And then it would be gone. And generally this would happen, like, during the time of a harvest moon. And
there must be energy connected to things and events, and that's all I can figure. Ships that come back, ships that linger, maybe ships that went down. Now I'm going to ask you the opposite. What did the Coast Guard say about this? I mean, if you guys would see it and file a report.
I'll put it this way. I was sent for psychological evaluation two different times. The first time I was sent to NASA Bay there and got to talk with some of the Air Force's people and some of the government's people, and they'd tell us, oh, well, you know, what you've seen was an electrical phenomenon that was caused by, you know, different types of gravity and all, you know, just a bunch of junk. Second time was told it was some sort of fluorescent stuff caused by the ocean. But personally, I mean, believe me, I've jumped out of too many helicopters and hit that water and some cold stuff and some warm stuff, and that there was a cold that you would never forget. You know, it was just that real.
I hear you, sir, and I believe you.
Very unbelievable, but
no,
very believable also.
I appreciate your call. Thank you. Jacksonville, Florida. I do. I hear you and I believe you. And you should believe people like that too, because these things do happen. It's part of our world, unless you turn it off. And I guess you can turn it off. And if you do, in all likelihood, these things will not occur to you or around you, or you will not be aware of them, and you may laugh at them. And if that's your way of handling it, I don't fault you for that. That's fine. West of the Rockies, you are on the air. Good morning. Where are you calling from, please?
Fairbanks, Alaska. Listen to KFAR.
Way up in Fairbanks, Alaska.
Yeah, we're having a heat wave up here.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, shouldn't it be getting cold up there now?
Well, we've only got maybe 2 inches, 3 inches of snow, about 36 degrees.
Real heat wave.
Yeah. I just wanted to mention, I don't think anybody's told you, but one of your favorite singers is going to be here this Friday.
Who?
Maria Muldaur.
Is going to be in Fairbanks?
Fairbanks, Alaska.
Oh, I hope everybody in Fairbanks says hi. Art said hi to Maria.
I wish I could go see her, but I work nights. I just don't work tonight.
Well, I'm sure that just about everybody who'll be going is listening, so everybody, please tell her Art said hi.
Yeah. quickly, I got a couple of real short things, and then I got a story.
All right.
I think God has sent a sign. It's that scream that you are playing that is a Sasquatch. In Australia, they call the Sasquatch a Yowie, and mm-hmm. here in Alaska, they don't call it a Sasquatch, but they call it Hairy Man.
They call it what?
Hairy Man.
Hairy Man. Well, okay.
Hairy Man. And they've got a good article in the Alaska Magazine,
mm-hmm.
which I should put one in an envelope and send it to you.
I would very much enjoy that.
I think you would. Anyway, the story is about a truck, a semi, that had been in a wreck and killed the driver, but there was no trailer attached to it. And the truck was repaired and put on lot, and it was sold. Well, every time it was sold, the person that bought it would bring it back and said they couldn't drive it. Something was weird with the truck. They kept bringing it back every time. Finally, one lady bought it. She wanted to get into the trucking, and she dealt with it. She just had to prove to her family and everyone around her that she could survive in the trucking industry.
Right.
And I may miss some of this because I read this in a little trucking magazine thing.
Right.
But I think it happened in Kentucky, and every time she went by, she'd get a cold feeling over her shoulder every time she went through this one area. Hmm. It was like the truck was beckoning her to go through here or something.
Right.
And as it turned out, the guy that got killed in that truck had left his trailer somewhere, but it was never found. It was never traced. They could never find it. But he had parked it next to a cliff. And somehow the cliff gave way, and it buried the trailer. And every time she went by this area, she got a cold feeling in that truck. And finally, the rains or something washed that truck, and it showed it. And she somehow got hooked up to that truck, and she took that truck to its final destination. And ever since then, that cold feeling in that truck disappeared.
Wow.
Now, is that a story?
That's a story.
But I was sitting in a semi, I don't remember where, a truck stop, reading this, and I just got cold shivers all over me when I read this.
I can imagine.
And I couldn't wait to get through.
Well, I'm glad you made it through, sir. Thank you. And again, yeah, that's weird. It's like, do you think it was the spirit of the person who originally had that truck? Or are machines and things, energy in the sense that people have energy, or maybe in a different but similar sense? I don't know. So many questions, so few answers, huh? So many questions. On our first time caller line, you're on the air.
Oh, Mr. Bell?
Hi.
Oh, I can't believe I got through to you.
You made it. Where are you?
I'm the unknown caller. But I'm west of the Rockies.
Okay.
All right. Hey, I'm listening to your ghost show, and I listened to you last year, and I thought it was great. That's why I'm staying up tonight listening to it.
Yes, sir.
I'm an atheist like Mark.
Yes.
And there's a lot of things I don't believe, and I listen to these ghost stories, and I throw them away. But there was something that happened to me, like when I was 20 years old, I had a roommate, and she was a single mother. We lived in a two-bedroom apartment, you know, totally platonic and everything like that. And one night, in the middle of the night, she comes blasting into my room, crying and screaming that she saw her father, her dead father, standing over her sister's casket. And her sister was just, you know, like 18 years old.
Mm.
And her sister wasn't dead. And she said her father was telling her, your sister's going to be hurt. She's not going to die, but it's going to be close.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm going, well, anyway, I calm her down and, you know, get her back into bed. And, anyway, the next day, we get a phone call from her mother saying that her sister was seriously injured in a car wreck. And go to the hospital and everything and see her, and she's like in ICU, you know. I mean,
sure.
Barely hanging on by a thread. And I never gave much thought to it, you know. Okay, her sister pulled through and stuff. But it's always bugged me that like, the day before the accident happened, my roommate came in and screaming and crying that she saw her deceased father over her sister's casket, just right there in her bedroom.
So it bugs you?
Yeah.
Then you're not an atheist.
Well,
you're an agnostic.
No, an agnostic is just a gutless atheist, I've always thought. But I'm listening to your show again, and this is bringing up stuff that there's stuff
well,
that
I don't,
you don't know.
Yeah, that's the whole point. I mean, how can you listen to this? You know, these are serious stories. As you know, I treat it seriously, and so my callers do. And how can you listen to this and not become a gutless atheist?
Well, yeah, that's exactly right. I don't believe everyone called your show is a liar. They're not. These things are stuff that happens.
These things do happen.
Yeah.
I appreciate your call, sir. I thank you for the call. I mean, how can you be? How can you listen? And then how can you say there is nothing? When we die, we just simply pass into blackness, into nothingness. That this life all goes for naught. That the energy that is our being beyond our physical bodies is not. Does not exist? I don't think so. No, I'm sorry, sir. You sound more like the gutless atheist you described. Or put more digestibly, an agnostic. The 818CS by Sanjean is, verifiably, the best radio in the world for the price. And it is virtually a total communications receiver inside the body of a portable. It covers AM, FM, shortwave. It does so in continuous coverage, 1 or 5 kilohertz segments. Now, I know, this is going to cause a lot of eyes to glaze over out there. But if you want a good emergency radio, if you want a good, all-purpose, very sensitive, selective radio with expensive filtering, wide, narrow AM filters, an RF gain control, a BFO, again, the eyes glaze over, right? And you're saying, what the heck is he talking about? Well, when you get this radio, whether you use it for good AM reception, talk shows, or you use it to bring the world to you shortwave, Radio Australia, Radio Moscow, Radio Havana, Radio France Internationale, whatever it is, don't buy a cheap piece of junk because you'll regret it, because you're going to love shortwave. And then you're going to realize you should have bought a good radio in the first place. Well, this is the best for the money. It's got a built-in cassette deck, 45 one-touch memories, a large LCD display, an RF signal strength meter, battery check, a million features I could never describe to you. It's got a built-in cassette so you can record anything, shortwave, FM in stereo, which means you can record all your favorite music, take it to the car, and play it. That's it. That is the Sanjean, and we know we've got the lowest price in America. How do we know that? Bob Crane will if you present him with an ad showing a lower price, he'll match it. No sweat from his brow. Nobody has yet done it. This includes shipping and handling and, of course, the very now famous Sea Crane Company guarantee. These are good people. It means, for example, if there's anything wrong with the radio, they're shipping you a new one before you have sent them the old one. It is a remarkable, ethical company, and they'll stick with you, and if you get stuck and need help, they help, unlike so many others these days. The price, including shipping and handling, $224.95. The number to call beginning at 7:30 a.m. Pacific time is 1-800-522-8863. That's 1-800-522-8863. Many of you health-conscious folks are familiar with antioxidants and their amazing health benefits. Now, vitamin C is probably the most famous of these. UCLA scientists found that antioxidant vitamin C can help avoid cancers, strokes, heart attacks, increase life expectancy an average of 5 years. Well, now, there are new antioxidants on the market, and listen, scientists say they are 20 times more powerful than vitamin C and 50 times the power of vitamin E, another antioxidant. They're called pycnogenols, the super antioxidants. You want to remember that if you're a health-conscious individual. Why? Well, according to Richard Passwater, Ph.D. and authority in the field, you're being bombarded by something called free radicals, toxins, environmental and otherwise, that break down cells, damage tissue, cause you to age faster, develop stiff joints, and wrinkle sooner than you ought to. How can you fight these free radicals that bombard you every day? Antioxidants and pycnogenols are the most effective antioxidant you can buy today. To order this amazing new food supplement I'm taking, call the folks at Health Naturally at 1-800-856-1119. These pycnogenols are pharmaceutical grade, made from 95% pure grapeseed extract. It's the very purest on the market, giving you the most benefits. Call 1-800-856-1119. That's 1-800-856-1119. All right, back to it we go. And on the wild card line, you're on the air. Good morning.
Good morning, Art. This is Judy, and I'm in Oregon.
Okay.
And I wanted to tell you that we live in a haunted house.
Oh, now you do?
Oh, yes, we do. We have for about 8 years.
Would you turn your radio off for us, please?
Yes. Matt, turn the radio off.
Yes, Matt. Extinguish it.
I'm sorry.
That's quite all right. All right, so in what form of manifestation do you get?
Well, when we bought it, it's actually an antique store, and we live upstairs. And when we bought it, I moved in before my husband did to get things straightened out. And the first day I was there, I went and was cleaning and everything, and it's on the second floor. And I went out the back door onto a porch area and was shaking out some rugs. And all of a sudden, the door slammed behind me. And it's a very large store, over about 8,000 square feet, so
mm-hmm.
I'm up there all by myself. It's getting dusk, and I couldn't get back in.
Oh, boy.
And it faces the river, so I don't have too many neighbors. Finally, I did notice somebody next door about 20 minutes later walking around, and I'm yelling and screaming to him to come help me get out.
Sure.
Back inside. So he did come around and jump the fence, and I had left a door open downstairs. Found his way upstairs, and lo and behold, he says, "How did you get out there?" And I says, "Well, I went out through the door." I have a deadbolt on that door, and he had to open the deadbolt to get me in. So, and that was the first of many, many experiences. And
well, I've always wanted to ask somebody this, and so I'm going to ask you.
Yes.
Why, pray tell, are you still there?
Well, they're not anything but pranksters. I'm not afraid of them.
So it's more of a sort of a pulling tricks on you kind of deal.
Yes, yes, because another incident was downstairs we have things like, you know, the Jim Beam decanter bottles. We sell those as collectibles. And we went down, and it's on a cement floor. And one morning we went down, and there was six of them in a circle on the floor, about 4 feet from the shelf.
Mm.
So things like that happen all the time, and people are there when they happen, too.
I wonder in the paranormal world what a circle of booze bottles means.
I don't know, but they're young people, and I'm sure they don't have ID cards.
Thanks for the call.
Thank you, Art.
You take care. Bye-bye. And I'm sure they don't have ID. East of the Rockies, you're on the air on Ghost to Ghost AM. Hi.
Hi, Art. This is Angela in Cheyenne, Wyoming.
Hello, Angela. How's Cheyenne?
Cold.
Cold. Yeah, I hear it's starting to get cold up there.
It is. There was a guy that called earlier, and he mentioned something about Effie Warren.
Yes.
I wanted to say it is haunted. I've heard several stories from out there.
About the airbase?
Mm-hmm. It's here in Cheyenne, and it is haunted.
Well, any place where many deaths have occurred, particularly a combative kind of death, is a place where spirits linger.
Yeah. I just wanted to plug that real quick, and then I had a story that I wanted to tell you.
Okay, real quick.
I guess about 6 months ago, my little brother came over to my house, and he was telling me that a friend of his, she was a young lady, newlywed, had two really, really young children, had just found out she had cancer, and she was going to be passing away soon. The doctor didn't give her more than about 2 weeks.
All right, I'll tell you what. That's a good cliffhanger. We're not going to be able to finish, so I'm going to put you on hold.
Okay.
And let you hold. You won't hear anything. Don't let it worry you. And we'll get back to you after the break, all right?
Okay.
All right, stay right there. In Cheyenne, where it's beginning to get cold. Would that be cold as in universal, or would that be cold as in cold spots? We'll be right back.
Continue with your calls to the Kingdom of Nine and Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell. Now here again is Art.
Black and orange stray cat sitting on a fence.
Hey there. It's Halloween.
Ain't got enough dough to pay the rent.
Have I freaked you out yet? Have they?
I'm black, broke, but I don't care.
Well,
right by with my tail in the air.
Stay tuned.
Stray cat, strut, I'm a I'm a feeling Casanova. Hey, man, that's that. Get a shoe thrown at me from a mean old man. Get my dinner from a garbage can.
From the high desert, where the moon hangs by about half. It's kind of eerie out there right now. This is Coast to Coast. Now, Ghost to Ghost AM. And now back to our ghostly young lady. And you're back on the air again. Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Okay. So my brother was really devastated about this young lady when he found out that she was passing away. He was the first.
All right, get into that telephone and talk up now.
Okay. Anyway, is that better?
That's a little better. You got to stay into it and talk. Project.
Okay. So my brother was friends with this lady, but I didn't know her. And my heart really went out to her, though, thinking that she was going to pass away and leave those two young children and her husband behind. And I kept thinking about her, and I couldn't get her out of my mind, like day and night for, I'd say, 4 or 5 days. And I was standing in my bathroom, and I felt something really strange, like almost a finger or something go across the top of my head. And I put my hand up there, and there was some kind of like a sticky goo on the top of my head.
You'd been slimed.
what my husband said, too.
Well, he's got a good sense of humor.
I don't know if it had anything to do with her, but it was just really weird.
Well, it might have. But it's a good slime story, and I thank you for bringing it to us. We get one at least one every Halloween. There is something about ghosts or entities or whatever you want to call them that many times involves a kind of strange slime. So when they did Ghostbusters, they kind of did a play on that, but there's nothing to play with. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Hello, Art. How are you?
I'm okay.
I don't have an actual story, but actually I wanted to answer kind of a question you asked earlier about Ouija boards, like whether or not one could get them. And you might find this pretty scary, but apparently it's marketed by Parker Brothers. Actually, not like a couple days ago, I just saw a commercial about a bunch of kids playing Ouija boards.
Really?
Yeah.
That's fine. I guess you can get them if you want to get them. Go ahead. My advice is, don't do it.
You don't have to tell me. Actually, I kind of think it's a stupid thing that they're doing. I'm an occultist myself, so I studied this field, and so.
Look, it's just a board. If Parker Brothers wants to sell it, that's fine. It's like sitting down. It doesn't matter whether, in my opinion, whether it's a Ouija board or some other instrument that you're inviting. You're concentrating on, and you're consciously inviting an entity to you. You know not what you do. It's not like Monopoly. It's not like playing Monopoly where you're worried about getting a hotel to wipe the other guy out. You're sitting down to consciously invite an entity to direct you. It is not a good idea, whether it's a Ouija board or whether it's a Monopoly board or anything else. If the intent is to invite something in, you'd be damn sure you think hard about it before you invite something in you don't want to keep you company. First time caller line, you're on the air. Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Yeah, I want to speak to Bart.
This is Bart. Bart Simpson. Art. Turn your radio off, please.
Yes, I just did.
Mm-hmm. Okay, go right ahead.
Hi, Art.
Hi.
Yeah, I've just, so weird. I just got, it's not really a ghost story. It's about my brother who died. And he died like maybe about 5 years ago. And when he was younger, he had a car wreck. And I guess what you'd call it a near-death experience. He was in the hospital for a long time.
Yes.
I'm kind of nervous. I'm sorry.
I can tell. That's all right.
Yeah. I can feel his presence now. When he was younger, he had a near-death experience, and I think he, and since he lived, I always thought it was like special. But he always said, like, you know, he's just, it's not special. He thought that it's like everybody had the power.
Well, why did you think he was special?
He was always interested in kung fu, and the things like martial arts and the power of the martial arts contribute to extra strength. And
well, I don't know about that, but it does, thank you, contribute to a concentration, and the martial arts focus you, and whenever you focus, you can run into something you might not expect. Here's an interesting fact that just showed up. Art, I just got off work, and it took me a while to settle down. A couple of stiff drinks so I can tell this to you. I've been home for about an hour now, and this is just exactly what happened. Let me start out. I work at a hospital emergency room. Consider myself a level-headed guy. I did not believe in ghosts, that is. Tonight I was riding my bicycle home from work. In point of fact, I was listening to you, reminiscing that it had been about a year since I'd been riding home at night, alone. It's been almost 1 year to the hour since my old riding buddy was killed while riding alone on this same street last year. We generally had rode together all the time. On this particular night, I'd called in ill, stayed home. My buddy Phil was run over by a drunk driver, not found for an hour or more, and died en route to the hospital. His bloodstains still mark the curb where his head struck, snapping his lower neck. Tonight, while riding home, I became aware of a feeling of having something like the sound of a car tire behind me, and yet there were no cars on the street. I kept hearing the sound, kept looking around. The sound got so loud, I could hear the through the radio. In other words, I was listening to the radio. I finally took off the headphones, stopped, and looked down the street. I saw Phil standing on his back next to me. As fast as light, I got on my bike and sped home. Phil stayed with me until I reached the crossroads where he died. I swear, I saw him, big as life. I can't tell you if I was having a 60s flashback or not. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hi. Hello there.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Art.
Yes.
I wanted to give you a little story about my experience with the Ouija board.
All right. Where are you?
This is Dan from Fairbanks.
Yes, Dan.
I was about 18, just graduated from high school, and this girl and I were playing with the Ouija board one night, and didn't think much of it, and I went home, and woke up the next morning, and I had a big antique Chinese mirror that sat on my dresser. It was, oh, probably 3 foot by 4 foot, probably weighed about 60 or 70 pounds.
Mm-hmm.
When I woke up, this mirror was sitting right at the foot of my bed on the floor, face down. Well, I didn't think much of it, except that I had a bunch of model cars that I had collected and built, and some bottles of cologne and stuff sitting on top of my dresser, and nothing had been disturbed, which meant that for this mirror to get where it was, it would have had to been lifted up off of the dresser, over everything that was on the dresser, moved about 2 feet from the dresser, turned at a 90-degree angle, and laid face down on the floor. Well, and that next night, we played with the Ouija board again. Went home, went to bed early in the morning, about 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. I hear this big, loud crash. I wake up, the mirror's in the same position on the floor, in the same exact spot, with the mirror broke into 100 or so little pieces, and everything on the dresser was laying all over the floor. Needless to say, that was the last time I ever touched a Ouija board.
Good for you. Thank you very much. Again, you invite things in when you do that, and you don't know what you're inviting in. It's like opening a door to a world where things exist, good and bad. Do you invite strangers into your home? Do you call on the street when somebody passes and invite them into your home, not knowing them? No. Then why would you want to do it with a Ouija board? Anyway, you may need a good night's sleep after this morning's show, and I have a sponsor that can sure provide it. It's called Select Comfort. Select is the key word. Comfort's important, too. It's a bed like any other, king or queen, and inside are individualized air pockets where springs used to be. Instead, they've got these air chambers, I guess I ought to call them, and they are inflated or slackened by your electronic command, and you've got a little electronic control on both sides of the bed. Now it gets even more unique, because each side of the bed can control the bed to be either stiff as a board, if you've got a bed back the way I do, or soft as a feather bed, or individually on, you know, from night to night, you can make it conform to your body. It is Select Comfort, and we don't expect you to buy out of the blue just based on what I've said. I've given you the outline. You call them. They'll send you a free videotape, and then you can take a good look. If you decide you want to buy it, then you get a 90-day in-home risk-free trial. The number to call to get the videotape to take the first step is 1-800-448-5700. That's 1-800-448-5700. Now, money. Pretty important in this terrestrial world, eh? When you look ahead in your life, do you see a cushy retirement with lots of money? Or do you see yourself barely making it? Are you working 9 to 5 now? Putting away a lot of money, are you? Saving it? No? Well, you might want to meet Ken Roberts, and we can introduce you. He is a financial investor and educator, and he's known around the world in 89 countries for his honesty, integrity, and something very special. His unique ability to teach people just like us how to invest in commodities with minimum risk. We've talked to a lot of people like Tim in California, a Learjet pilot. He made $30,000 profit. Bob in Utah, retiring from truck driving after he made $48,000 in his first year. Now look, commodities are usually regarded as a very risky venture, but not with Ken Roberts. He'll teach you how to invest, and you invest on paper until you're confident, and then you'll just throw the paper away, start using money. Because, you know, who wants to be losing that kind of money? That's how confident you will get. Now, we will send you what it's called a money kit. A 44-page report and a cassette tape, free of charge. You look it over, decide if you want to give it a try. Call Ken Roberts Company. He's got a good number, too. It's 1-800-GOLD-KRC. 1-800-GOLD, as in that that glitters, and KRC, as in Ken Roberts Company. Again, 1-800-GOLD-KRC. How many of you remember a time when you could take a penny to the corner grocery store, and there you could buy a nice piece of candy or even a postcard? Well, of course, today, the convenience stores have a bowl of pennies on the counter with a sign that usually says, take one if you need one. Can the dollar be far behind? You know, you really can't buy anything for a penny anymore. In fact, a dollar will only buy what a dime would a few years ago. The only form of money that still buys what it did once before is gold. Over 100 years ago, an ounce of gold was worth $20. For that, you could buy a very nice new suit. Today, that same ounce of gold is worth nearly $400, and guess what? You can still buy a really nice suit. Today, you need to have some gold in your investment portfolios for protection and profit. My friends at North American Trading will be happy to show you how you can own gold in privacy and safety. It's really simpler than you might think. Call 1-800-877-9799 and ask for their free information. Investors have always turned to gold during times of inflation and economic uncertainty. Don't wait till it may be too late. Call 1-800-877-9799. You don't have to be rich to own gold, just smart. All right, back to the lines we go. Now, I want to say again, if you would like a copy of this show, this particular program, we do offer copies of this. It is a yearly event called Ghost to Ghost AM. And the way to get a copy of it is to call 24 hours a day, 1-800-917-4278. That's 1-800-917-4278, 24 hours a day. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hi.
Hi, Art. This is Robert from New Orleans.
Hello, Robert.
First, let me say I got your book yesterday.
Oh, you did.
I am very, very happy.
Tell everybody, I've really not been soliciting comment yet, but is that one quality book or what?
Oh, yes, sir, it is. It's much better than I thought it would be.
Well, there you are. I'm glad to hear it. We'll do a day later this week and solicit comment. Anyway, it is Ghost to Ghost Night.
Okay, in New Orleans, I guess you know we bury people above ground here.
I've heard.
Right. Well, my grandmother's buried in one of these old cemeteries.
Yes, sir.
We go and we clean them out every so often, you know, clean up around them and weed them. And me and my younger son will go walking and looking for the dates on each one of these tombs. As we're going through one day, we notice that a couple of them have been broken into. So we start looking into them and we're seeing that, you know, the bodies have been disturbed, the caskets are open or broken or chipped out in corners.
Oh, boy.
As we go to one of the oldest ones, which is about a block down from my grandmother, it was an 8-year-old girl who died during the time that there was a bad scarlet fever going around in New Orleans where thousands of people had died.
Yes, sir.
As I climb up to look in there, I notice there are two bodies in there, but these are recent bodies, like a day or two.
You mean like the people who had been desecrating?
Yes, that's exactly who they were. There was two of them, two young men. One face down and one face up. The one face up had an expression on his face like you've never seen in your life. I ran and told the keepers of the ground, and they called the police, and the police came and everything. And about 2 weeks later, I had called to ask, you know, what had happened to the guys. And it said, as far as I can tell, both guys had died of heart attacks. And the one who I saw, I'm sure, died of fright. And they said the coffin where the little girl had been in was, of course, opened. It was a metal coffin at the time, and they said they guessed they were robbing it at the time, and something happened that scared them to death.
Oh my God! What a story! That's a true story.
Oh yes, it's very true. My son talks about it all the time, and every Halloween, it's the first thing we start telling the rest of the family about.
Oh well, thank you for sharing that with us. And no, I really do mean that. Thank you, but that is a scary story.
It bothers me once in a while.
We can only imagine what they saw.
I know what they saw. That little girl took her revenge when they tried to break into her coffin.
Jeez. Thank you for the call.
All righty. Take care, Art.
Take care. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Oh, hi, Art.
Hello
there.
I'm
Mary from Bakersfield.
Hi, Mary. How you doing?
Oh, pretty good, but that one did scare me.
Oh, boy.
I can just imagine that. Mine scared me, that one scared me more. Now,
right.
This happened when I was about 18, 19. It was about 3:30 in the morning, I guess, and it was winter time.
Kind of like about now.
Well, no, it's not cold up here yet.
No, I meant the time. It's a little before 4.
Mm-hmm. And I was asleep in bed, and I woke up, and I was sleeping on my left side, and all of a sudden I woke up, and I turned over to my right side, and I was facing the door of the bedroom, and being cold, I had the habit of throwing the covers over my head. Well, I did that this time, and all of a sudden, about maybe 2-3 minutes passed, and I started getting scared, very, mm-hmm. very frightened. And I tried to come out from under the covers, and I couldn't pull them off. And I mean, I clawed at them and just pulled, and I couldn't.
Oh, I wouldn't like that.
And all of a sudden...
Covers are supposed to protect you.
Well, these didn't. Since then, I've never slept with the covers on my head ever since then. But all of a sudden, there was a scream in my ear, just a shrill scream. That my head just, you know how you feel when you've been screamed in your ear when you were small before, you know, kids?
Sure.
And my head just, it just vibrated the way that scream. And I tried to call my father, and I'd open my mouth and nothing would come out. And I'd just be open and gasping and trying to call. Yeah. And finally I managed to just say, Daddy, just barely got it out.
Yes.
And when I said that, then the covers came off. I was still trying to take them off, and they came off all of a sudden. And, well, like I said, ever since then, I just do not sleep with the covers over my head, not a sheet.
My dear lady, I've heard a lot of I jumped under the cover story.
Well,
stories, but I have never, never, never heard I went under the covers and then tried to get out, and the covers wouldn't come off. That's
they would not.
Awful.
I know. They just would not come off. And like I said, I still do not sleep under with my head under the covers anymore.
I can't say I blame you, but it's like, gee, there's nowhere to hide.
Well, hide under the bed. There's no place. Get underneath the bed or someplace.
Well, look, I appreciate your story. It is unlike any I have ever heard. And I'm afraid it's going to have to be the topper for the... for the day, I'm afraid.
I'll be.
You know, the night just kind
mm-hmm.
of flew by, as it were.
Well, I've been trying for quite a few years to get in. This is the first time I managed.
You've been trying for years?
Well, about 4 or 5 years.
I kind of wish you wouldn't say that. It discourages people.
Oh, it shouldn't, because I finally got through.
Well, see, there you are. All right.
Uh-huh.
All right. Well, wait a minute. There's a tradition here.
Oh.
With our last caller.
Oh.
You get to say good night, America.
Oh, good. Good night, America.
Take care. Well, it has been fun and a little scary. But you tend to get what you ask for, and I wanted scary stories, and y'all did not disappoint me. That last one from New Orleans kind of got to me, though. At any rate, again, I want to remind you to get a copy and archive of this program, stripped of the commercials, with only the frightening content remaining. You can call 1-800-917-4278. Let me give you that number one more time. 1-800-917-4278. Thank you all who joined us during the night. And all I guess I can say is... from the high desert. Good night, America.